Barnstable. Hello, Kate.
Hello there.
Hello there.
Yes, there. yeah, look, I mean, what people are forgetting here is that, okay, what Dominic Cummings did, compared to the fact that, you know, over 18 million people have come into the country since lockdown.
Yeah.
I mean, it doesn't make any sense. I mean,
which
who's
bit?
Been coming in? 18 million people. Who's been coming in? Who are the people who have been dying?
Yes, we've got no idea. We have no idea. And it's, I think it's more than 18. I think it's about 20 million people have come in without checks from some of the most diseased places in the world, China and America, yet. And we've got absolutely no idea where they went, who they met, or what they did when they were here.
Well, why were they allowed in the first place? I came back from holiday on the 23rd of March, and my family and I went into lockdown for 14 days.
Did
just
you?
In case. We thought, you know, we had two long-haul flights and went through Heathrow twice, and we thought, oh my God, we've probably got it. We jumped in our car, we drove back home, and we locked down.
But to be fair, though, Kate, everyone was in lockdown anyway, so you weren't really taking extraordinary measures. You were just doing what everybody else was doing.
Well, exactly. But we were told, when we came back here, we were told by our neighbours, look, you know, everyone knows you've been away, so we will do your shopping for you, stay where you are. But my wider point is that the whole, this plandemic, it just, you know, it doesn't sound right to me. There's a lot that's wrong with it.
Wait, back up. Did you say plandemic?
Yes.
What does that mean?
Have you not heard that term?
I have, but for those that haven't, go on.
Well, first of all, it doesn't seem to have been as serious as it's been hyped.
Well, now, what do you mean by that? Serious? How many deaths equals serious?
Well, that's the other point. The death numbers. I don't get this. My friend's dad the other day, he was very old, he slipped in the bath, hit his head and died, and he had COVID-19 put in his death certificate. I mean, what's happening there?
I seriously doubt that that actually happened. Where's the evidence that
it
happened?
It happened to a friend of mine. She told me.
He slipped in the bath and they put COVID-19 on the death certificate?
Yes.
I'm afraid I don't believe you.
Well, you see, you're the one who's wanting facts. You're the one that's saying, oh, the politicians don't take facts, the journalists are all right.
Yes.
But when I give you a fact, you don't accept it.
Well, where is the evidence that that is a fact?
Well, she saw the death certificate.
Well, she said, we said, he so, said, there's not. That's not evidence, that's hearsay.
My friend told me she had seen the death certificate. Why would she lie?
I've got no idea, Kate. Why would anybody say that it's a plandemic, suggesting
because
that this is actually planned by government source forces?
No, it's not the government. I mean, Boris's first instinct was to resist lockdown, protect the vulnerable, but there was that absolute media frenzy hype. Everyone's been panicked like crazy. Oh, we're in lockdown. People are just, you know, you're talking about commandments as if it's some sort of religion, as if you want it.
Well, I know I'm going to regret asking this, but who is behind it? Please don't say Bill Gates or George Soros.
I don't know who's behind it, but there's a lot about this that just doesn't add up.
If I'd said, don't say George Soros or Bill Gates, would you have said George Soros or Bill Gates?
Yeah, and maybe Tony Blair as well.
Tony, you remember Tony Blair, don't you, people?
No!
Yes, that's him. He's put a virus out into the world that's killing everybody for his own special reasons, whatever that might be.
Yeah, but he's a globalist. I mean, these days...
What does that mean? He is a we're all globalists now. Do you like oranges in the winter? You know where they come from? Elsewhere.
Don't be disingenuous. It's about globalists and nationalists, right? That's where we fit into the two camps now. Everyone is basically picking sides.
No, I'm not picking a side.
Yes, you already have done.
In what way?
If you're against Brexit, then basically you're a globalist.
That's not really... So you either like things that come from elsewhere...
No. You're being disingenuous here. That is not what I'm saying. You're either politically you're a globalist or you're a nationalist. You pick a side, and
just to be clear, a nationalist is somebody that only takes products made in within their own country. Is that right?
Whoever came up with that definition?
I'm asking you.
Well, what a stupid question, if you don't mind me saying.
Well, okay. Well, I'll ask you another stupid question. Can you give me your definition? Wait a minute. I'll ask you another stupid question. You know, just for my amusement. What is your definition of a nationalist?
A nationalist is somebody who believes in the nation state, in the primacy of the nation state.
Meaning what?
Meaning that every nation should be able to make its own laws.
Okay,
and
well, oh, good. I'm not having that conversation again. I had that conversation for 3 years with people who are wildly misinformed and get all of their information from Facebook, as it appears you do. The plandemic. Oh, God, I should have stopped talking to you when I heard that.
Warning, warning.
Plandemic? Tony Blair is behind the virus? What's frightening, Kate, is that you sound like an intelligent person until you start speaking. Here's a call in Milton Keynes. Hello, Melvin.
Hello, Nick. It's difficult to believe what is going on with the virus in other parts of the country. Is it overblown? Because in Milton Keynes, especially the area where I am, we don't have to wear a face mask when we go into the shops. Some of the shops haven't got shields.
No, wait, back up. When you say you don't need to, what do you mean by that?
We don't have to.
But you do.
You don't have to because it's not law.
You do have to.
No, you don't, because you've not gone through Parliament.
Oh, God. Well, what
if it's not an act of Parliament, it's not law.
Right,
so we're free to do what we want, and I'm very pleased about it, because I don't wear a face covering.
Right, why not?
Because I don't believe I have to, because I think the virus is
because it's
is
not law, because, right, you're nitpicking, in other words.
I think it's a myth, an urban myth.
What is a myth?
The virus.
You think the virus is a myth?
It's an urban myth.
Right, what makes you say that?
Well, I haven't seen anybody in front of me drop down dead of it.
I have, just so I know, are you joking?
No, I'm being deadly, deadly serious.
Right, so you don't think it exists because nobody has died in front of you?
That's right, without the virus.
Has anybody died in front of you of cancer?
Not that I know of.
Right, so is that a myth?
Well, cancer's not a myth.
What makes you say that?
Well, it's obvious, isn't it? Cancer's a known thing. The virus isn't known.
It is known. We know about it.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is, we don't understand what all the fuss is about. We can stand as close as we want. We're not, nobody bothers us.
Us? Who's
a
us?
A supermarket. There's no one-way systems, you know?
Right.
And I mean, I think it's fake news.
Right. Okay. I think you're out of material. I didn't believe a word you just said. Nobody's that stupid, Melvin. Oh, there's people very upset about masks in this country. Anti-maskers have been flouting new coronavirus laws in force from yesterday, which make the wearing of face coverings in shops, banks and shopping centres across England compulsory. An anti-vaxxer called Lara spoke of people avoiding her, quotes, like the plague, as she filmed herself shopping in a farm store and a Tesco branch in Devon without covering her nose and mouth with a mask, avoiding her like the plague. That's actually what she said. You mean avoiding you like the communicable disease that killed people? That kind of plague?
Yes.
Wonder why. Lara, who tweeted that she is an anti-vaxxer and that she had not clapped for the NHS once because they're paid to do their job, said she had never felt so uncomfortable in a shop in my life, and said that the staff were amazing and looked at me like a normal customer. Wow. Well, there's quite a lot to unpack there. Quite a bit. Where do you even start? Well, she's an anti-vaxxer. Or, as the PM asserts...
I think he's betraying a quite stupefying ignorance.
She, not he, sexist. She hadn't clapped for the NHS. Well, I mean, that's okay, but why would you advertise that fact? Why would you put that on the internet? Why would you tweet that, unless you were just trying to pick a fight? Best to probably keep that to yourself, unless you're trying to get a rise out of people, also known as trolling. And if you're trolling, back under your bridge, troll. And I feel, I've never felt so uncomfortable in a shop in all my life, she said. Well, if you feel uncomfortable doing something in a shop, maybe stop doing it. Whenever I feel uncomfortable, I usually try to stop the feeling of being uncomfortable by, stopping doing the thing that makes me uncomfortable. And she says she was looked at like a normal customer. The staff were amazing. They looked at her like a normal customer. Well, she wasn't a normal customer because she was deliberately doing something abnormal. You know, but apart from all of that, well done. In the same story in the Mail, they reported that a tattoo artist called Aaron filmed himself entering a Sainsbury's without a face covering which is not entirely accurate because he had taken the precaution of covering a part of his face with a tattoo.
Oh, no.
You know, one of those people. Anybody approaches me with a tattoo on their face, I'm thinking, what a nice, kind-looking person. I trust that person. That person looks like an upstanding member of society. No, that's right. I think something's about to go off. Don't make any sudden moves.
Warning, warning.
So he films himself going into a store with no mask. And he said masks were useless. You know, because he's, he's done his research. And he told staff they cannot enforce the new policy. And he's filming himself doing it. And then he puts his adventures up on Facebook. And then there was a video posted on Facebook. And if you think that was stupid, wait till you hear this. A video posted on Facebook entitled Play By Your Own Rules shows a man being told to wear a mask in Sainsbury's before grabbing a bag of sweets without paying and running out of the store laughing. So again, a man filmed himself going into a store without a mask and then when told to wear one, steals something from that shop and then puts the film of it on social media. Wow. I think that ringing is Charles Darwin on the phone. He wants to talk to you about an ism. You know, before you die of something stupid. The new rules are contentious, with some people finding masks uncomfortable and some libertarians complaining they are being muzzled by the state, says the story. Oh, for crying out loud. Muzzled by the state. It's a mask, not a cell. Grow up, people. Any chance of people growing up? I'll take that as a no. Boreham Wood, Lee.
Hello, mate.
Yes,
mate. How you doing?
Good, thanks.
Good. Well, listen, I can't believe what I'm hearing here, Nick, to be honest with you. These people were probably out clapping for their National Health Service on a Thursday night on a regular basis. Now, the majority, as I understand it, of the people that have died within the NHS have been black or Asian ethnicity. Now, what the hell do these people think they're playing at? By gathering in groups like this, every one of those should have been arrested and charged with a breach of the peace. Because, to be honest with you, my wife is currently in Barnet General Hospital suffering under a COVID-19 lockdown. Now, what the hell do they think they're doing?
What's a COVID-19 lockdown? What do you mean by that?
Well, she's in Barnet Hospital in isolation at this particular moment in time.
Okay.
She's had several tests for COVID.
Yeah.
She's got a lung infection that they believe may be well tied in with it. So they're not letting her out of her room. I can't visit her. Nobody can visit her. And these people are out there butting heads together without face masks or any protection whatsoever, and they're putting the people at risk. Those people, if it's a 1-to-1 and they say that that's acceptable, if they say it's 1-to-6 and that's acceptable, not when you've got 6,000 or 7,000 people in the same area. That's totally disrespectful to the NHS. It's totally disrespectful to this country. And the reality behind it is, I understand that someone has been killed and it's definitely a racial attack. I won't take that away. And that needs to be stamped on. But what I am saying is, protests like this under the current climate are not the way to deal with it. We need the law to come in on this, and we need the government to step on it. These people gathering outside Downing Street, throwing a few bottles or whatever they're doing, ain't going to change jack. These people need to understand there's a legitimate process in place. You know, this has got to stop. We're trying to protect a country here, not a few individuals that believe that they've got the right to abuse a situation that was laid down by government to keep us all indoors and keep us safe.
All right. Okay. Message understood. Thanks, Lee. 0345 6060973. It does occur to me, though, that having seen the pictures of crowds today, people weren't that further apart on pictures that I've seen of tube trains packed in the morning, people going to work and unable to distance from their fellow passengers because there weren't enough trains being run. So it's not the only place where people have congregated close together. People traveling into work have not chosen to do that. They've been forced into that position. Let's have New Malden, Duncan.
Hello, Nick.
Duncan.
Thanks for having me on. I really appreciate it. And I'm sorry, I spoke to you twice before and I had arguments with you over Brexit. Oh, and I apologize for that.
Well, that's hard to believe that anybody would have an argument with somebody else about Brexit. Really? What can we have been discussing?
Because also for, I don't know, 3.5 years, I didn't agree with a single thing you said, which is my, you know, that's fair enough for me, I guess.
Yeah.
But I finally agree with something that you were saying tonight.
Oh, well, I must have got that wrong.
No. I have a very close friend who's a consultant doctor. In his hospital, he has 50 COVID patients. They are all fine, and they're rapidly sort of improving and will be discharged. He has 100 non-COVID patients. Their hospital has 1,000 beds.
Yeah.
They have 850 empty beds. The corridors are empty. His partner is a nurse who works at a different hospital. She's on a banking, you know, like a nurse bank. She hasn't been called in for 6 weeks. There's nothing for her to do.
Yeah, it's remarkable. This is not what you read in the papers. This is not the idea you have of how the NHS is coping. I mean, if the headline tomorrow on the front page of the Daily Mail was doctors lounging around with nothing to do, you'd be stunned. But that is actually the truth in a lot of the major hospitals in the country. Because for the sole reason that we don't have a health service anymore. We have a service that has been repurposed to fight a virus. Everything else has been put on hold. That's why
that's
the NHS
true.
Has done well, is because they've done abysmally badly in every other regard.
Well, yes, there is that. I mean, the doctors are saying, well, he's a consultant, and he's saying the sad thing is that people are so terrified about going in and having things treated that they should normally have to have treated.
Yeah.
That in a year's time, or 2 years' time, or 5 years' time, far more people will die from, you know, not having cancer treatments, not having all sorts of other treatments, than would ever have died from corona.
Yes.
So, I don't know what to say. You've in the past kept on talking about, let's talk to experts, let's get an expert opinion. You know, I'm not a doctor, I just have a friend who's a doctor, and so, you know, this is not me saying this.
Well, if you've got a friend that's a doctor, that makes you a doctor. I think that's actually true.
No, I'm not pretending to be a doctor, but if you could get an epidemiologist on who would explain, because my friend is always saying that this virus is no different from any other virus that they were taught about in medical school, that it comes into the community, it zaps around for 6 weeks, lots of people get infected, but the vast majority of people with corona are totally unaffected. And we're never told all the time that the people who, sadly, I mean, and it is terrible, lots of people have died. I'm not trying to, put that down, but they are in their 80s and their 90s, and they mainly have dementia and all sorts of underlying health problems. And that is how all viruses work, unfortunately. That's just the same. Can I ask you one question?
Okay, go on.
Which is, how many frontline doctors and nurses
Hang on a minute. When you said, can I ask you one question, my phone leapt into action and said, hi, how can I help?
Okay, well, how many do you think, I know the answer to this, so yes. I'll tell you in a second.
Right.
How many doctors and nurses in the frontline corona ICU wards have died during this epidemic?
12.
You know, I would have said, when I first heard this, I would have said, you know, maybe hundreds or 50 or da-da-da, or maybe 12, like you said. But the answer is none.
I'm not sure that's true.
No, it is true. That is true.
Well, I know of at least three, I can picture them, actually, medics who have died. So
medics, yes, medics. I'm talking about in the corona frontline wards.
Oh, right.
And there is there's a reason for that, because they have been protected and they've got the correct gear.
Well, I'm not sure that's true either, because the doctor I know caught coronavirus because he was given dodgy gear that didn't come with specific instructions. These are people that have been doing medicine their whole life, but they were given a mask that had a tiny little valve in it that did not come with instructions about what to do with the valve, and so he was intubating somebody and got the virus from having dodgy PPE.
But did he die?
No.
Well, no, I know, but I don't know. I think if LBC could get just people on to who are experts who could just tell us the truth about all of this.
Well,
there's an awful lot of misinformation.
Yes, but I think that you may be misinformed, because I think the number of doctors and nurses who have died is not inconsiderable. I think it might be in the hundreds.
But they're not in. Yes, I agree. They're not in the front line, and we hear
But by definition, they are in the front line.
And but I'm saying technically in the COVID wards, you know.
But
in
if
the
you
actual...
go into a hospital, you are in a COVID ward, because hospitals have been repurposed for the sole reason, almost the sole purpose of fighting the virus. I think you have the genesis of a good argument. You may be ruining it by harping on this.
No, I understand, because as soon as you start mentioning, oh my God, it's, you know, people haven't died as much as people think, you're not allowed to say that. We're not allowed to say that. We have to toe the line of...
Well, stand by, because I'm about to say it a lot. I find it uncomfortable to be thinking these thoughts, because it puts me in the same territory as those on the far right, whose initial... It puts me in the same territory as Donald Trump and the people behind this government, whose initial response was... never mind about some old people dying. We've got to save the economy, and so
we can't say that. Obviously, no. But ask doctors; they will tell you the truth, because they're doctors. They deal with illness all the time.
But what you mean is be guided by the science. But there's no such thing as the science.
No, I know, because different scientists will tell you different things, because there is no one truth about science. You know,
but not this specific thing. There's truth about gravity, and there's truth about light, but there's not truth about this virus, because it's too new.
Well, I know that's what they say, but if you talk to an epidemiologist, they will say that all viruses work in the same way, actually, and that this is no different from any other virus, and that people are very, very... For some reason, they're paranoid. The public are very, very scared.
I suspect...
I think the government has done very well in the beginning to make us all scared.
Yes. Well, by their ineptitude, they have made us all very frightened. They then, on top of that, gave the messages that increased our fear. Yes. So in that regard, it's been a tremendous success to make us all petrified to leave the house. That's going to be the big problem now, is to get us to come back out again and start going to restaurants and bars and theatres and cinemas and shops to restart the economy. If assuming there is an economy still left by the time we all emerge, blinking into the light. Exeter. John.
Oh, hello. Is that... hello?
Yes, John.
How are you?
Great, mate.
Excellent. Listen, I agree with a lot of what you've been saying. I think that there's a real and present danger, and the infection is spreading. I mean, I've been caught up in it. I'm a big fan of James O'Brien as well, and I think it's incurable.
Well, it is incurable.
But also, I agree with a lot of what you've been saying about people going to the beach. But what I think is that British innovation will win. You know, they will find ways, different ways for people to pee in the sea, and different plastic bags will be invented.
Right. Okay, well, I'll look forward to that. Thanks a lot, mate. Just from the moment he started speaking.
Warning, warning.
Yeah, bells were going off in my mind. Camden, Brian.
Hi, Nick. How are you?
Good, thanks.
Good, good. I think you're the only presenter that speaks a little bit of truth, at least, what you're saying about the, where you're saying about the immunologist. Oh, sorry about that.
Brian, are you on the run?
I am, yeah. it's just what happens when you speak too much truth in this world right now. But yeah, when you're speaking about the immunologist, saying about everyone coming out, a lot more American doctors and everyone are speaking out and saying that we shouldn't have had the lockdown. It's unnecessary and it's unlawful what they've done to us, really, putting us all under house arrest. It's pretty much what they've done to us. So really, a lockdown needs to stop. We need the herd immunity. We don't need to be isolated. Lowering our immune systems, wearing the mask, lowers your oxygen levels, lowers your immune system. Everything they're telling you isn't ideally the correct thing to be doing right now.
That's a bit of a blanket assertion. I'm not sure that
it's not assertion. Quite a lot of doctors have been speaking out in America about it. So
I think
you find the NHS have been silent. It said on the 9th of April in The Guardian, NHS staff have been to talk out, otherwise they'll face disciplinaries. So they've been silent. That's why you're hearing nothing from real NHS staff. Because they're not allowed to talk out.
Well, I don't think that's true either. I've read no end of things from NHS staff.
No, look it up on the Guardian. They've all been silent. Half of them ain't talking out about anything at all. And the American doctors are speaking a lot more about what's going on. And then half of them are being, anything going on YouTube, they're silencing that as well. Even the malaria drug that they were using, that I think Donald Trump's using. So he says, but that's been proven in America to actually work.
No, it hasn't. The opposite of that is true. It's been proven in America and in other countries as well. It does not work.
Judy Mikovits mentioned it, and she was an immunologist.
You mean one person you could find said something that you agree with, and then you dismiss all other opinions? Study after study after study says that hydrochloroquine, there's more syllables in there, aren't there? Hydro something chloroquine, does not work, causes complications up to and including death.
Gates. Why are we listening to Bill Gates, who's not medically trained? Why are we listening to him? Why does he want a vaccine in the world? And the vaccines have microchips in them, by the way.
The vaccine has microchips.
Yes, they will be microchipped, and that's how they're going to track and trace you.
Okay, did you get this off Facebook? Yes. God, there's so many people out there that believe this tripe. Southend, hello, Chris.
Oh, good evening, Nicholas. Hello.
Yes, Chris.
Be on so soon. I know you're going to hate to use this term, but I do find it refreshing that someone like you is saying. It's all going against the grain of the mainstream media in a way. Really.
Oh, my God. Oh, no. He just said mainstream media.
Warning, warning.
Back away, everybody. Just smile. Don't make any sudden moves. Back slowly out of the room. Mainstream media, he just said.
Why do you hate the term mainstream media?
Because it's usually said by numpties who are trying to convince you that anybody that has any sort of reputation in the news business is not to be believed. What you should actually believe is the source of just anybody that writes anything on the internet, sitting in the basement of their parents' house, in their underwear, some 50-year-old bloke is clacking out on his computer some nonsense about contrails or nanobots being injected into your brain by Bill Gates. It's just this, oh God, I can't bear it.
I perhaps do agree that there are people out there that use that, but I think what I would say better too is I think there's been maybe a lot of irresponsible journalism over this this pandemic. I mean, let's not forget the Spanish flu killed an estimate of 50 million people worldwide, and so far what the coronavirus has unfortunately killed is nowhere near that figure. I mean, you've got to bear in mind that we've got much more advances in medicine, technology, science, like that.
Yeah.
I mean, there was one guy...
Well, the major difference between that and this, as I was pointing out yesterday, is that for the Spanish flu, they didn't do a lockdown. The pubs stayed open, the restaurants stayed open, football continued, crowds gathered. None of that, none of what we're doing now was happened then or in any of the other virus pandemics that have swept the world. What we're doing now is a science experiment.
Well, I mean, you're right, it is. I mean, and the thing is, people forget, you know, I mean, there's 7.4 million people that have been furloughed. And some people, you know, I hear sometimes people on the radio and the TV saying, oh, I'm not going to go out until we get a vaccine and stuff. And
well, that's never then. You'll be going out never.
Yeah, that's completely unrealistic. I mean, the thing is, I've been working in my job. I'm a key worker. I work as a driver, unfortunately. Unfortunately, like I say, in my job, I work on my own mostly, so I can keep my distance. But again, you know, I've mingled with people in warehouses, keeping our distance. And like I say, I must admit, because for me, it kind of feels a bit like a surreal moment that I'm living in, where,
I go
work, I've been down the beach, I don't see people dying in the street, all these dead bodies collapsing. But yet, if you watch the news all the time, you think that you don't have to look at someone or breathe. And suddenly you get a whole, 6 feet in front of you dying.
I was reading in the press just today that it's something of the order of 7 in 10 people who tested positive don't even know they've got it. They have absolutely no symptoms of any kind whatsoever. So for the vast majority of people, the virus just bounces off them.
Yeah, but here's the thing as well. The other thing that really annoys me as well, and there's some guy... there's two things I'd like to point out. This guy said, oh, all these people down the beach, don't they realise how selfish they've been? And he equated it to drink driving. And I thought, well, no, it's not the same. Because, you know, if I go out in the street or whatever, A, you're assuming I've got it for me to spread it on to you. But not only that, drink driving is an intense thing. It's like, I mean, for starters, I wouldn't drink drive anyway because I'd lose my licence, I'd lose my job. I need to keep my licence, my job. But again, it's such a bogus comparison.
Well, I'm not sure it is, actually. If you deliberately, with a malice aforethought, go onto a beach and start breathing over strangers, then it is likely that even if you don't have it, then you will get it by, you know, getting all hugger-mugger with the people that you don't know. And then you will go and pass it to maybe the bloke in the warehouse, and both of you can be completely fine, except that the bloke in the warehouse will go and visit his parents, and they'll get it.
Well, yeah, but again, this is all done on probability and chance and things like that. And like the guy said on the show last night, there is such a thing as a quality of life. I mean, yeah, it's existing and things like that, but I just think to me, I mean, one of the things I read on the BBC's website is they reckon that the chances of you dying if you're over 70 now, in this period we're living now, are no higher than they were last year. You know,
I think it's 1%, isn't it? 70 is about a 1% chance of being killed by this virus. That may be assuming you get it. And then that probability goes up by, I think, 5% with every 5 years in age after that. But you have to remember that the average age expectancy of people in this country is not much older than 70, 80 years old. So what we're doing now is we're closing down the economy. We're ruining the lives of of generations to come for an untold number of decades in order to extend for a short period the lives of people who are already at the end of their expected time on this earth.
The whole thing doesn't make sense from the get-go. The whole thing for me is that, honestly, I mean, I'll tell you something. If this is proven in a year's time that we've overreacted to it, or the other way, I mean, either way, whether we've overreacted to this or underreacted to this, the bottom line is, Nick, this has been, as The Guardian said, it's been part of the mainstream media, sorry. This has been what The Guardian said. This has been the single biggest scientific policy failure for a generation.
Well, I've been saying for a while now that this, I think historians will look back at this and think that it is the biggest overreaction to anything in history. It's like spilling some water on your kitchen floor and instead of mopping it up, setting fire to the house to dry it out.
But you're saying that you don't, that you're saying you think the drink driving analogy is correct. But surely, let's say, if I drink tons of beer or wine, spirits with it and go and drive, I know that what I'm doing is wrong, and I know that I'm drunk. But if I go to the park and socialise with people, again, I don't know I've got this virus, and that's there. I'm not doing, my intention is not to
kill people. If you drink drive, your intention is not to kill people either. I think it's a pretty valid comparison. I know you're chafing at it, but trust me, it's valid. Newcastle, Fred. Newcastle.
I think the outlook is pretty bleak, Nick, from the words that the last few speakers were talking. And I mean, even yourself, you're saying in the 70s the thing was bleak. I wasn't alive then, but I'll tell you one thing. All these people who are saying that we should consume less, how stupid do they think we are? All these documentaries, the mainstream opinion right now is, oh, it's great to be a Marxist, it's great to be wanting to consume less. Let's all just be poor. Let's listen to the woman who lives in a hut and doesn't even have any, you know, any idea. You know, she's not got any signal on her phone, but we should listen to her about the economy.
Well, let me ask you about this, Fred. Is it more important to be happy or to have lots of stuff?
Both. I mean, the two come hand in hand. I mean,
no, they don't. No, they don't. Wrong.
So all these poor people, they're really happy, are they?
No, you don't have to be poor to not surround yourself with lots of consumer goods that you don't actually need. I mean, think of being on a desert island, and all you have to do.
Whoa! What about all this stuff that we don't need? The thing is, we do need them, though.
No, you don't.
Like half. Well, why are we all living in poverty then? We're all poor.
Yeah, because you spend all your money on stuff that you don't need.
Like what?
Well, when did you last buy a phone?
I'm not saying I'm in poverty. I'm saying all the poor people are in poverty.
Right. Well, yeah, the poor are, by definition, poor.
Look at this woman. She's living in a hut. She can't even get a good phone to call a radio show to tell you about it.
Well, it might be a hut made of solid gold. Maybe that's why she couldn't get a good reception.
I doubt it. She's a Marxist, mate.
Right. So what's your point, though?
My point is, all these people who are actually advocating themselves to be poor, like Furlough Boy, who wants to sit at home and do nothing and not learn anything, or like he doesn't even, he's sitting arguing to you, telling you Richard Branson got a bailout. He doesn't know anything. He doesn't even know the point he's arguing.
Yeah, well, okay, so on that specific, he was incorrect, misinformed, yeah, but I think in general, it is justifiable to say that the government appears to be bailing out multinational corporations.
Would you give him a job?
What, Richard Branson? I don't think he needs one.
Furlough Boy, I wouldn't. I didn't employ him. People who can't even get that right when they're phoning into a radio show. We've got a million young people not in education, employment, or training. They're not doing anything.
Yeah, but again, right? His point was correct, if not specifically right. We are bailing out multinational corporations. That's actually true. I mean, there's a burger joint that turned over $1.4 billion last year. And we're giving government money to them. I mean, that is probably insane. So on his general point, yes, the government seems to be in the business of helping out those who are already spectacularly rich. I think that the money could probably be better spent just giving everybody a certain amount to keep them going, such that they don't feel as though that disaster is just around the corner. It would make them more likely to start a business, perhaps, which is going to be very important from this point on, because there's going to be a lot of businesses that fold, a lot of empty properties on the high street and in business districts and elsewhere and so on, which need to be replaced. I mean, this is going to be a great period of change. Massive churn is coming. And unless we find some way of making it feasible for people to actually start businesses and replace those that have fallen, then, well, God, we're still going to be in this mess in 10 years' time. So how are you doing, Fred?
I'm doing all right. I'll be fine. But you can't drill into people to be a go-getter. Like, either they're going to start a business or not.
No, I understand. Yeah, but no, you can't. But you can make it more possible for people who have the will or the desire or the gumption to start a business to do it. Because if people are just are living on the edge of catastrophe, then they're not going to take a bet on themselves. But if people have some sort of safety net, then yeah, it seems to me more likely that they will.
Well, I don't see. Well, right now this isn't a safety net. What we're doing right now is sanctioning any form of business activity and paying people not to do so, paying people not to spend, actively encouraging people to stay at home and do nothing.
No, not really. Not to stay at home and do nothing. The whole point of the furlough scheme is so that businesses won't collapse because of an immediate lack of income. It will give them the opportunity to regroup and then open when it is possible for them to do so. I mean, this furlough scheme isn't going to go on forever. It's shortly to close, isn't it?
But already I think it's done enough damage that, like, enough businesses have closed that we need bailouts for stuff. So we're talking about bailing out these big businesses. Yeah. My point exactly is this. This furlough boy, middle class, this one saying that we don't need consumerism. I'm saying poor people, no, we do need more money, actually, right? That is the exact thing we do need, because they're the ones who are going to be left out, like you're saying, is the people who are going to be left behind. Exactly, fine. If you know, we're talking about loans, business loans that won't be getting given out and things like that. But I don't think the answer is stay at home, pay people to stay at home. The answer should be get back to work. We need people getting back to work so people... Because, look, we're pulling our own teeth out, queuing up to get beans from the shop, missing funerals, postponing weddings, nothing's happening, yeah. Doors closed, business...
Right, well, if we could get into a time machine and go back to January and do everything... Or actually, you'd have to go back further than January because Boris Johnson, in his enormous wisdom, defunded the exact... organization that would have helped us through this, just like Trump did in America. It's almost as though they were singing from the same hymn sheet. Pair of peas in a pod they are. Norfolk, hello, Alan.
Hi, Nick.
Alan.
Yeah, you've just stolen a lot of my thunder there, actually. But let me go, as it were. Dominic Cummings... and Boris Johnson, you have to assume they've got all the facts in front of them, so they've got their finger on the pulse, right? So Dom, he goes off on his jollies, and Boris's dad goes off to Greece via Bulgaria.
Yeah.
Now, why would they do that? Why would they do that? There's a few possible answers. One, they're selfish. But I favour the idea that they know the truth, in inverted commas, and the truth is that this coronavirus is just so overblown. And can I just set me stall at, just very briefly, I've had the actual flu, proper flu, twice in my life, and it puts you in bed for 2 weeks and another 2 weeks to get over it. But every time we have a flu epidemic, the whole world doesn't shut down, right? But because they've overreacted and they can't be seen to say, oh, hang on, we've made a mistake here, they have to carry the life through. Do you know what I mean?
Yes.
Because otherwise they're just seen as the fakes that they are. Do you know what I mean?
Well, I don't know about fakes, but they will be admitting their mistake if they then abandon everything that they had been telling us up to this point. This is an experiment we're going through now. The human race has never done this with a virus like this before. We've seen viruses before, but we've never done lockdown before. This is not an anomaly. I mean, Sweden, rather, is not the anomaly because they didn't shut down. Sweden is the normal. We are the anomaly. This is the first time we've ever done this. And you'd have to say it's not going very well, being as how we're about to face the worst recession for 300 years.
But they would rather that happen than stand up and say, oops, we got it wrong. They would rather do that because, you know, they know better than us. And then they've done the one thing that I've always believed is their most powerful tool, and that is fear. And that's what they've... It's proven that if you want to control the population, keep them in fear. And that is it.
Well, they've certainly succeeded in that. The problem, as I've said over and over again, the problem with locking down is getting people to come back out again. And people aren't that keen to do that. I know I'm not.
Well, I ain't either, but not for the reasons of infection, etc. I'm just fed up with all this queuing and people jumping out of your way because you think you've got the bubonic plague. And they're going to go round with a Darth Vader helmet and a bell ringing, unclean, unclean.
Yeah, you. By the way, I think you would look fantastic with the Darth Vader helmet on. Do you mind if I say that? All right, thanks a lot, Alan. Southport, Bayrouse.
Good evening.
Yes, sir.
The two issues which I'm going to raise, they are connected to each other. You know, for the past fortnight, we are having a very good weather at the moment. Well, obviously, yeah. And the part of the country I'm living, you know, every single day, this is for the past 10 days, well before the government relaxed, you know, all this lockdown and all that. Every day, not in hundreds, thousands of people, last bank holiday, 250,000 people was on that beach. Today, after 12 o'clock, you couldn't go on the beach because it was that busy, right?
Wait. Back up. 250,000 people on Southport Beach?
Southport Ainsdale Formby, yes.
Right. How do you know that?
Well, but that's a good guess because hang on. Because when his air show is on, you know, they say 100,000 came on.
Right.
And I can see this was a lot more than the air show,
okay.
Right?
Mm-hmm. 250,000 people, that's almost a 500,000, yes.
No, 250 is a 250,000.
Well, let's agree to disagree. Go ahead.
No. Anyway, nobody, you know, observing any social distancing. The kids are playing next to each other. Nobody was bothered about the kids' safety, right? I am sure between all those people, there are teachers and they're all saying, oh, no, we can't go open the school on the 1st because of the welfare of the kids, of the public safety, the teachers and all that, which in this area, Liverpool and Merseyside, they are not going to open it on Monday because they are so worried. Didn't seem like between all these people, nobody was bothered about, they didn't have any care in the world.
I don't think that it's, for me, it's not an issue of the children's safety, it's an issue of the teachers' safety. The teachers are the ones that are likely to be felled by it. It just bounces off children, mostly.
Look, you know, all the measures are taken, this, you know, marking, reduce the size of the classes, wash base day, you know, that they're checking their temperature. How far do they have to go? And as I say, these people are objectively not safe. But on the beach, as I say, there are like you couldn't put a drop of in because it's that busy. They weren't bothered about it. So all of a sudden, is one rule there and another rule somewhere else. I just find it, you know, incredible. Some people come on and start criticizing the government. You know, don't get me wrong, I'm not the favorite, they're not my favorite, you know, government anyway. But, you know, and then they do exactly opposite what the government asked them to do, you know, so how can you justify that?
Well, you know, I really think the opposite of that. I think that it's remarkable how well we've behaved, considering that our lives have been taken from us. Our lives, our jobs, our money, our future, people's homes, their relationships, everything that they had planned for the rest of their lives has just been whipped away, and with barely a murmur from the general public. I think we've been incredibly good.
Do you know other countries? You know what? This country really done so well. You have to congratulate the government. You know, they put who is losing money? People are making more money than they were making before.
Well, yes, there's the people that already had money are making more money. Billionaires have done fantastically well out of this coronavirus. They've done fabulously well. The people that have more get more, as usual. The people who have less get less, as usual. It seems to have increased the wealth divide, not just in this country, but in the whole world.
Don't forget, this. In a capitalist society, you know, the 5%, you know, they are the one who gives the order. The rest of 95% is like as I said, you know, they only pay them so much not to die, so they're not to do their work because they're not going to do it. They're like a slave anyway. That is philosophy of the capitalist society. But as I say, this country is doing a lot better than, you know. And then, you know, these about the figures,
Wait a minute. Finish that sentence. This country is doing a lot better than
any other countries.
Which country?
The Euro.
This country is doing better than other countries in Europe.
Regarding looking after their own people, yes. As I say,
What measure are we doing better than any country in Europe in looking after our people? What do you mean by that?
Because in France, they only pay 50%
of your salary. In this country, they pay
80%, and some firms, they make that another 20%, so you get your 100%. Your salary. So that's not bad, is it?
Well, it depends. I mean, it's not free money. It has to be paid back. And we, the people, the poor dopes who pay taxes, what little there will be left after the smoke subsides, then...
Yeah, don't forget.
It will have to be paid back. So it's not free.
Yes. No. Hang on. The country is like a household. They've got no revenue. One person, you know, whoever works, bring the revenue in, so they spend it. So I know you pay your taxes, but you use the road, you use the swimming pool, you go to the library, you have a free NHS.
Okay, well, first of all, this country is not like a house. That's completely incorrect analogy. It's not even remotely like a house. And even if we go with that analogy, then what if all the people in that house lose their jobs? Then we ain't got no tax.
I don't quite follow. How do you mean lose their job? For what reason?
Are you kidding me? For what reason would people lose their jobs now?
I don't know what... You know, can I just make another point? Might be not relevant. You know when they were talking about PPE, right?
Yeah.
It's personal protection equipment, right? Mm-hmm. Some of these care homes and nursing homes, they charge £1,500 per week per person, right? They make millions.
Wow.
In a matter of 2 weeks, they all became bankrupt. Oh, we haven't got the government is not helping. Why don't you put your hand in your pocket from all those millions you made in past?
I don't think people are making millions from care homes. Here is Merseyside. Chris.
Hi, Nick.
Chris.
Good evening. I just want to... Can I mention a video I've just watched?
Can you mention a video you've just watched? Sure. What is it?
Okay.
Koyaanisqatsi. Is it Koyaanisqatsi? Not that one.
Okay. It's debunking a narrative with Professor Dolores Cahill. Yeah.
Okay.
This lady is...
I hesitate to ask, but I'll do it anyway. What's that about?
Okay. It's about COVID-19.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
She's a world expert in molecular genetics.
Oh, right.
So
a world expert? What does that mean? A world expert?
Yeah, she is, yeah.
But what does that mean, a world expert?
Well, you'd have to watch it to hear this lady, okay?
Yeah, don't you mean she's just an expert?
All right.
I mean, world expert implies that she is the foremost authority on the subject.
Well, she could be, actually. But anyway, all I'm saying is, I think this lady is worth interviewing with.
I absolutely will not do that. What's she on about?
Sorry?
What's she saying?
Well, she's saying that the lockdown is not required. Yeah. And other things as well. But
Why is she saying the lockdown is not required? I mean, she's not the only person who's saying that, but why is she saying that?
Well, because she's as I say, she's an expert in molecular genetics, looking into all these things, and yet you really have to watch the video.
No, I'm certainly not going to do that.
To get the understanding.
Can you not praise it for me?
Well,
I mean, you just watched it. What was she saying? Why do we not need to lock down?
What she's saying is, it's... What's happening is all false. It's not required. The lockdown is not required. There is better ways of dealing with this. There is medication out there that can be used.
Please don't say hydroxy.
Why not?
What's it? Why not? Because it causes certain developments in the body, up to and including death.
Well, I think all I'm saying, Nick, is this lady is an expert on these things.
Right. If you don't but many other this, people have, are experts okay, on, no, on this okay. thing, and they have said the exact opposite. Why did you just pick on her?
Well, she also mentions other experts as well.
Yeah. Oh, well, you should have said.
From different nations, yeah, who go down the same line as her, right? So all I'm saying, if you're not interested in it, people who are listening to this, have a look at it. Debunking the Narrative with Professor Dolores Cahill. The government needs to be challenged on this, because this lady is prepared to take on, she's an Irish lady, she's prepared to take on the Irish government, and she'll take on anyone with it. So that's all I've got to say anyway.
Okay, well, you make it sound like she wants a fight, but that's not probably what you mean. You mean intense discussions. Okay, well, thanks for the warning. I'll give it a steer. Maidstone, Dean.
Hello, Nick, you all right?
Yes, good, thanks.
Yeah, you didn't have many figures for the man that was saying that Sweden's mucked it all up.
Well, I don't know what kind of figures that he needed, because the game...
I would have liked to have seen more figures. Right. I would have heard more figures. I've got some for you anyway.
I've got some figures. I've got some figures for you. 6, 12 and 83. There you go.
Death per million per capita, right?
Yeah.
UK, 4.95 people per million, right? Sweden.
A million? That's not true.
Sorry, 2.71. Sweden is 4.95, so they're nearly double what Britain is. So we've had 128 people die out of 68 million.
That's not true.
That's true.
But
that's
it isn't true. No, I think you're talking about per week. That's the last week, not in total.
It might be the last week.
Yeah.
No, that's today. That's June 27th. That's today.
Right, so it's the last week. That's not in total.
That might be summary for the week. But 128 people a week to shut down the whole world?
Right.
44,000 out of 68 million to shut the world down. Really? Does that make any sense? I don't understand it.
Well, no, I don't understand it. And I think that in future people will look back on this, and I'll say it again, as the biggest overreaction to anything in history, particularly if there is another virus. This isn't going to be the last virus we face. And if there is another more serious one in the next 10 years or 20 years, we'll still be probably trying to get over this in 20 years, financially speaking, then people will think, wow, okay, what are we going to do to a more serious one? I mean, how can we lock ourselves in for more than 3 months? It's impossible.
Exactly. I think it's a big case of mass hysteria. Matt Hancock's the one who's got to get sacked anyway, because he sanctioned the old people that were in the hospitals back to the care homes.
Matt Hancock didn't do anything that Boris Johnson and his personal the angel on Boris Johnson's shoulder didn't. No minister has done anything that he wasn't instructed to do, or she, sexist.
Well, Matt Hancock's wanted to be the face of it, so I think he should be the face of the fall, you know? He's the one that's standing up saying he's protecting the NHS.
Yeah, well, you know what? The buck used to stop at the top. The buck used to stop at the top, but now it doesn't get anywhere near it. Curious.
Yeah. Well, what about Henry VIII keeping his son Edward locked up? And he never survived, did he?
Yeah, that's the best what about I've ever heard. What about Henry VIII?
Well, he locked his son up, and his son died, didn't he, when he got let out into the open. So right. I think for all those who aren't sending their kids back to school, get the history books out and see what happens.
Oh, yeah, because, history. That's absolutely what I want to do. Lavinia Grace, Bermondsey.
Well, good evening, Nick. How are you?
I am super. Thanks for asking.
Right, well, what I'd like to say... Now, after all these years, we are going back here to basics, and I'm so overwhelmed and really pleased about that, you know that, because I've been telling you for ages that everybody needs to go back to basics, you know, and it's helped, in a way, having this Corona 19 happen, which, yes, it was unfortunate, but there's a lot of people out there that they're sort of woken up, they've realised that the simple things in life are the most precious things.
Right.
And can I just say this, Nick, as well?
Well, just before you do that, can I just clear up what it is that you're actually talking about? What do you mean, go back to basics?
You,
me?
Tarzan, and me, Jane. That's what I mean, Nick.
Well,
does that make sense?
No, actually it doesn't. Do you want to have another run at it?
And also, can I just say something else, Nick?
No, we have to clear up what it is that you're actually talking about. What do you mean, go back to basics?
Get yourself dirty. Go out there and get into the mud. Get into the earth. Climb an apple tree. Fall off an apple tree. Just go out there and feel the grass. You know, just do the simple things in life. Because what I've noticed, a lot of my friends who have their businesses, who's been working sort of 24/7, and now this has happened, they're doing things that they've never done before.
Yeah, mostly to do with apple trees, is what I heard.
Yeah, well, what they're doing is like, they're noticing things like, you know, they're phoning me every night and saying to me, God, I can't to believe this, Lavinia. And I'm saying, what's happened now? They're saying to me, like, we can smell the grass. We can see the butterflies.
I think that answers a lot of questions.
Want to score some pot?
You've been smelling the grass. Thanks a lot, Lavinia Grace. Okay. Has this show started yet? Here is Stockton on Tees. Hello, Brian.
Yeah, good evening, Nick. You okay?
Yes, super duper. Thanks for asking.
Yeah, I was wanting to talk about Boris Johnson and Dominic Cummins.
Yes.
And to Boris first, I admire this bloke even more now.
He's an empty vessel. He's just a collection of...
Just a second. Well, that's what you keep saying.
And,
Well, just a second.
Go on, then.
Right?
Here we go.
The easy thing for Boris Johnson would have been to sack him.
But now, by easy, do you mean
just
right?
Just a second.
Do you mean the correct thing?
Correct.
No, the incorrect thing. But all that's true about Boris Johnson is, call him names, all he's bothered about himself, he's selfish. He does anything to get power.
Yes.
He's proved that wrong, hasn't he?
No.
Because the easy thing to do would have been to get him out the way.
No, unless Brian, the easy thing for an ordinary politician, an ordinary prime minister, yes. But he appears to be bereft of ideas. He has been elevated to a position that he's wanted his entire life, that he is not sufficiently qualified to occupy. So he
Boris
needs
Johnson.
His henchperson to tell him what to say and do.
Boris Johnson has an 80-seat majority. He's the most powerful politician for a long, long time. And he knows that, right? And all these people keep throwing brickbats at him. He keeps swatting them away.
Yeah, including
easily.
100 of his own MPs.
But he is doing it, being very courteous. He doesn't get into slang much doing it, right? And he's put him away, put him back in the boxes very courteously. He's a clever man and you can't see it, right?
Oh, well, I can't see it because it's not true. Boris Johnson appears to me to be a completely empty vessel, a collection of ticks and affectations and a cod Churchill impression.
He's a winner and he's going to keep on winning, same as Cummins is going to. They've never lost anything yet and they've got that much power, they're going to keep winning, right?
Winning? What do you mean by... So what does keep winning mean to you?
Wait till after next week. They'll have won in Europe.
What does that mean? Won in Europe?
They've got the fishing thing. You said fishing didn't matter, by the way.
Oh, for crying out loud. Fishing. You're still banging on about fishing.
No, it's the EU keeps banging on about it. That's how little they have in hand. Keep going on about fishing, wanting more fish. It's the EU that's wanting that, right? Our waters. And you
our waters.
Matter.
Our you waters. What are you talking about, man? The fish that comes out of our waters, we don't eat. It's not to our taste. We sell it to Europe.
Right. You said the main reason doesn't matter is because we make nothing out of it. Well, why do the EU want it so much then?
God, you people, people like you are just absolutely obsessed. I mean, you won, okay? This is how angry and furious you are when people like you win. What is wrong with you, Brian?
You're
obsessed.
You're obsessed at making it so difficult, along with newspapers, media, the opposition. I mean, you've got this...
You can't possibly think that the majority of the newspapers in this country are against your position. What are you talking about?
You said we've won, and you've lost. So Ed Davey is a Romanian.
No, wait a minute. Back up. Back up. I said that what?
So Ed Davey, right?
No. Back up. What did you just say before that? I said that we won. We, as in who?
No, you said settle down because you won. You accepted it. That we've won.
Well, yeah, right, you did. You won. You won. You think you've won something? You won the referendum. I know that you personally think that you've won something out of it. That you are going to benefit in some way. I guess eventually you might come to the conclusion that that's not necessarily true.
Will you please on this program pull over and tell Sir Ed Davey? He says, "Sir, right?" And he's wrote a letter along with the SNP bloke, right? Your sidekick of Sturgeon and Greens and all of them asking for an extension, asking for Barnier to ask for a 2-year extension. He's wrote back to them, right, saying, "I will look into it, or I'll try and help you." Now,
who's written?
They can't accept defeat, can they?
Oh my God! You can't accept a win. That's what fries my mind about people like you. You're still fighting this same battle. What is wrong with you, Brian?
Boris Johnson cannot be stopped. He's the most powerful man in the country. Even this virus is not going to stop this damn virus, right?
You're saying things that everybody knows already. Of course, he's the most powerful man in the country. He's the Prime Minister. This is not news, Brian.
But the change in the reform and politics.
You would normally barge into a pub and bore everybody to death from the end of a bar. It must be absolutely eating you up inside that you haven't been able to bore people to death in a bar for the last couple of months.
You tried to sack a man like Cummins,
I bet,
right?
You clear places when you walk in the door.
No, you will. You tried to sack a man in Cummins, right, who was trying to reform politics. He's trying to change politics. And he's well on his way to doing it, right? I don't know why you were calling him, Nick, because you keep saying politics needs reform.
He's been trying to change politics. In what way?
And he's winning as well.
For God's sake, stop saying that.
He's rocketed up the civil servants, hasn't he?
And you think that's to the benefit of the nation, do you?
This country is being
Trumpified. Do you really believe that is the benefit of the people in this country?
You've got Trump syndrome.
For God's sake! Of course it is. The same people that brought us Trump brought us Brexit, and people like you still can't even address that fact. Look, the people that brought us Brexit are billionaires.
They pulled the
wool massively successfully over people like yours. Yours are
the man, people like me.
Yeah, people like you. People like you were hoodwinked by a succession of lies that and the evidence have been before you for so long, and you still refuse to even look at it, let alone to admit that you've been fooled.
Yeah, look, you're going to find out within 6 months that we haven't been fooled. Brexit is going to be a big success. Define a big success.
Here's what this virus has enabled politicians to do from now until the end of time. Blame any fallout from Brexit on the virus. That's what they'll do from now until forever. Anything that happens that is not a tremendous success will be blamed on the virus. If it only hadn't been for the virus, Brexit would have been a tremendous success. And people like you will buy it. Not insanely, just at the very idea.
It doesn't matter if there's a virus or no virus. It's going to be a success no matter what success. And that's what they're frightened of. It's going to be a big success.
People in this country are frightened of success. Oh, my God. I just cannot understand people like you who, even when they win in your terms, are still complaining. God, imagine what it would be like if you'd actually lost. This is what you're like when you win, Brian. It's insufferable.
I'm not complaining.
I think that to the nub of it, you don't. I don't believe that you believe any of this stuff. You just like a fight. you just call in for a fight. You're a troll. Back under your bridge, troll. God, I've taken, and if you're new to this, I've taken his call so many times, and it's the same thing every single time. Donald Trump, hero. Boris Johnson, hero. Everybody else, fake news and a traitor. It's just the same thing over and over and over again for year after year after year. Every week he calls. Mostly, I just leave him sitting on the board there because I just can't take it. And he'll wait for an hour to get on the show just to say the same thing again, just because he likes a fight. You know, the juices start bubbling in his brain and it almost feels like he's alive. And this is what he's like when he wins. Can you imagine what it would be like if he had lost? Oh, he wouldn't need a phone. He'd just be yelling loud enough that we would hear him from Stockton-on-Tees. Anyway, it's been a delight as always. please stay within 2 meters of me. Well, 200 meters. 200 miles would be a good idea. Socially distanced within 200 miles. Let's have Kensington. David.
Mary, see what you've done.
David will be with us in a moment when he realizes we're on delay. In 3, 2, 1. David.
Hello.
Yes, David. Just in time.
Hey. Yeah, I was just calling about the school options that they have proposed to people. And hello?
Yes. School options, yes.
Yeah, and you've got a lot of parents out there that's kind of 50-50 with their kids going back. Now, they say they did say on national TV that kids cannot, well, they wouldn't get infected as much as the elderly or people with underlying issues. In my kids' school, there's a few teachers that have underlying issues. And what if the children bring it in and they infect one of the teachers? Because they said you won't have any symptoms maybe for the first week or two. And then the teachers goes back home to their loved ones and then pass it on. So I don't know where we stand with that.
Yeah, it's not the children that we should be most concerned about. It's the teachers who are in front of a class full of snot-filled, coughing, sneezing children. Yes, those are the people that I feel worried about.
Yeah, kids always come home. The kids always come home with the flu.
Yeah.
The flu. This is just like the last caller that called us just now. I'm with him 100%. Because I know a lot of people that's had the flu or, if they want to say coronavirus has been around for many years. So a lot of viruses that are out there have been called coronavirus.
Yeah.
So the common flu that you get on a yearly basis is what I would say that we are undergoing at the moment.
But that's not true though. It's much, much worse than the common flu. I mean, it's not as bad as it could be. I mean, if this was as bad as SARS or MERS and was as transmissible as the coronavirus is, then we'd be looking at an absolute catastrophe, because I think SARS or MERS took something of the order of 20-30% of the people that got infected. But this is a tiny number of people that get infected are actually affected seriously badly. So, but it's much worse than the flu though.
Okay, has any professionals come on, like the gentleman said before, and was to kind of enlighten the public to the coronavirus?
What do you mean?
A professional come in to say, because basically we went through a pandemic when we was at, I think about 7,000 worldwide.
7,000?
7,000, 8,000 or something like that when they declared a pandemic and the lockdown. We wasn't at 30 or 40,000, I don't think we was. I don't know if I can remember. Can you enlighten me with that one, I think?
30,000 or 40,000 what?
Deaths of coronavirus.
Well, the lockdown was in March and we weren't anywhere near that figure. No, countries were locked down when they had deaths in the single digits.
This is exactly what was troubling my mind, because you need to have a lockdown or a pandemic at like maybe 40,000-50,000.
No, that's too late.
Pardon me?
If you have 40,000 or 50,000 deaths and then have a lockdown, that is somewhat too late, isn't it? You want to have a lockdown to avoid 40,000 or 50,000 deaths.
Yeah, but this is what was in, by the WHO. The WHO would say to you that you need to have like 50,000 or more to have a lockdown.
No, that's the opposite. The opposite of what the World Health Organization would have to say. Unless you mean the WHO, as in the band, and then what they think about it is neither here nor there. I think you are sadly misinformed, David. In fact, it's remarkable after all this blitz of news and information that has come your way that you think that. I'm alarmed. Let me take a call in the meantime from Hillingdon. Jazz.
Hi.
Hi.
Hi, Nick.
Yes, Jazz.
That was long.
Long?
Quite long, what you just explained a little while ago. Anyway.
Yeah.
So, you almost lost me on the subject now.
It was a couple of inches too long. About 6'3", yes.
Fine. It was long. You know, this time of night, I mean, I was really... So, are we still talking about Dominic Cummings?
If you like. If you're talking about Dominic Cummings, we're talking about Dominic Cummings.
Okay, good. Okay, thank you for confirming that because I...
Okay, well, thank you. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Okay, let's not waste time now.
I think you're too late for that.
Right. In terms of him, I think I've had, about 3-4 thoughts on him in the last sort of 2 days.
Yeah.
I thought my initial thought was he was really, really wrong, really, really wrong. How dare he do that? Because we've been really, really careful without symptoms and we've been really careful. So we're a family of four, 2 young children, 2 key workers, and we've been doing our best. Now, today, my end thought on that is with Dominic, I think he should get a penalty. Some sanction, whatever you want to call it.
Right.
No, but I'll tell you why. I mean, you laugh. My reasoning for that is he's an expert, isn't he?
On what?
He's got some, well, you know, whatever his expertise area is.
Whatever his area of expertise, that is his area of expertise. Yeah. Yes, we know that's absolutely true.
Hang on. Hear me out, please. I don't think... He should be, initially I was thinking he should be sacked, absolutely. I mean, what a hypocrite. My thought now is, why should the rest of the country suffer? I don't think, if he should get sanctioned, we shouldn't suffer in terms of that. If he's got the expertise to advise, you know, the Prime Minister or the government, and then why should we suffer not getting that? Because if he's sacked today, tomorrow, whenever, or yesterday...
We would only be shooting ourselves in the foot. That's what you're saying. We would be denying ourselves his excellence.
Yeah. What I'm saying is let's not...
Throw the baby out with the bathwater?
Oh, what is that stupid noise in the background? All I'm saying is...
Very unkind to yourself.
Sorry, go on, listen. Yeah.
Yeah, so you think that we shouldn't fire him because he's a giant brain?
No. All I'm saying is... No, I don't know if he's a giant brain. All I'm saying is if he's got expertise to help the rest of the country, even though he's made this stupid mistake or whatever, absolutely, let's deal with him. But not now, not when, you know, if he's got that.
Because we've been told that he's a genius, we should give him a pass.
No, not give him a pass at all. Let's deal with him. But let's not take the people off those podiums that have got expertise to deal with it, because I'm not expert to know, you know, what's right or wrong for this country. I don't think...
Okay, well, let me ask you this then, Jazz. Do you think that he has shown himself to be a bright and intelligent person?
I think he's shown himself to be a hypocrite.
That's not the question. Yes or no? Has he shown himself to be a bright and intelligent person?
I think so, and I only can say think so because I'm trying to work out who he was because I tried to look him up and everything. And I think,
All right, if you had any idea who it was we were talking about, then you could form an opinion. I understand.
Okay. So can I also talk about LBC just very quickly?
Well, I don't know. I think we're on a dangerous territory here. She wants to talk about LBC now.
Warning, warning.
I bet it's a complaint.
It's good stuff. LBC are brilliant. I think LBC need... Hello?
Yes.
LBC...
Hello?
Hello?
I think LBC are a good place to... You know, LBC should ask the right questions. You've got so many callers asking lots of questions, and I wonder... Like, I wonder, often listen to you guys, and I think, well, is the Prime Minister listening to this? I wish he would, because he would learn a lot from you guys than what he, you know... Majid is really good. The only thing that I think that...
Yeah, I knew there was a but, yes.
No. The only but is that sometimes he's got lots of callers calling, and they're challenging him, and they're asking questions. They start off really stupid, and then Majid gets really upset, and rightfully so, because nobody should bully anybody online or, you know, face-to-face.
Yeah,
or
can I suggest that you call Majid with this?
No,
You want me to pass him a note?
No. This is to do with LBC. It's not to do with Majid.
Yeah.
All I'm trying to say is that, you know, when he stops the callers.
No, I don't. You seem to be still talking about him.
Well, okay.
Why don't you put your complaint on a postcard and pop it in a post? Can you do that for me? Make sure it's an essential trip. Bromley, hello, Luke.
Hi again, Nick. Listen, this is part two of a last conversation, and that is, I'm quite concerned because it's come to my attention that Boris Johnson never coughed. Number one symptom of having coronavirus is coughing, dry cough. He never coughed, and he seemed pretty good afterwards. I'm just concerned that perhaps did he actually have the coronavirus, and I know a number of nurses who would say he didn't.
Well, he did disappear for, well, he still does. He just pops up every now and again, so maybe he was coughing.
I'm not saying he wasn't unwell.
Right.
I'm more proposing that he had pneumonia, which is what thought that he probably had, which is considered to have a number of people, because you know, people talking about this coronavirus, people were supposed to be dropping like flies, do you remember?
Yes.
It was supposed to be, look, I know a top consultant, okay, and he wouldn't tell me initially because all the figures were like top secret. But after a while, I kind of got the figures roughly out, and he said, look, there's going to be mobile morgues for every town in the country. They're all being built, being pre-planned, okay, secretly.
Yeah.
They didn't want to alarm people. The figures, which they were reported for, which are planning for by the government, was 1.3 million dead. In this year.
Well, this was one of the original scare stories that forced Boris Johnson to rethink his plan, if you could call it that, his plan to do nothing, then to reverse and change tack entirely too late.
And another one, Prince Charles. When did you see him cough? They're supposed to have breathing difficulties for about a week after.
I guess. But a lot of people have absolutely no symptoms of any kind, and other people have aches and pains, and some have a dicky tummy, and which is what I think I had. I mean, I don't know whether it could have just been a bad mushroom, but I felt bilious for a little while there, and I assume that that's what it was.
Nick, that's my hope. You're a popular guy. A lot of people know you. You know a lot of people. I know quite a few people too. I don't know any... Well, I know one person who's been tested positive out of everybody. What about you?
Yeah, no, I don't know anybody who's had it, no.
Well, right, okay.
Oh, no, wait. I do actually know one person that's had it, and he is a doctor who was working in a COVID ward. So that's not...
Right. So I'm just wondering, when we see all these people in Italy with their heads in bags and stuff, and it all looks terrible, and, you know... It's not nice, but I'm just thinking, what happened to this thing that was supposed to plague the world? And people were talking about a cure for a virus. Well, there isn't a cure for a virus. There isn't any cure for any virus. AIDS is a perfect example. It's the bacteria.
Yeah, I think that people are hoping for something that doesn't, that in all likelihood, will not appear, a cure or a vaccine of some sort. I mean, it's almost an assumption now on a lot of people's part that we are about to be relieved of this this threat, but it's probably going to be here forever.
Yeah, my first and main point is that did he have a cough? No, he didn't. I'm just concerned that perhaps we're taking up the garden path a little bit, and this whole thing has really messed up the whole country in a big, big way.
Right.
And we've ended up seeing hardly anybody with it.
Yeah.
So okay. Let's get back to normal as quick as possible, please.
Okay. Herne Hill, Adrian.
Yeah, hi, good evening.
Adrian.
Yeah, I'm actually a publican. We own a country pub. The reason I rang, I thought you were a little bit harsh on that chap who called him a drunk on the fact he had six pints, but that's by the by. We haven't had a bit of bother. We have not had a bit of bother. We own like a village pub, and also another reason I rang is that.
Well, what do you mean you've not had a bit of bother? I mean, the implication is that you ordinarily have bits of bother.
No, not at all. But you know.
But what do you mean? Just, no bother. Bother in what way?
What I mean, my son, is that you know this idea that you know people start using pubs, they'll start kicking off and are stupid. Hmm. But you know.
Do you talk to your customers like this, by the way?
No, not really.
Right.
Well, probably. But you know, the main point I'm saying is that businesses that are important, whether it's a pub or a restaurant, you know, or a shop or whatever, businesses are really, really important. You know, they're important for the economy, for people's happiness and all that sort of stuff. So,
you are all over the shop. Have you been sampling your own wares? What are you talking about? First of all, you were saying there's no problems and now businesses are important. Is there anybody that's ever said, ever said businesses are not important?
Well, not being funny. I actually personally think you're being slightly facetious. I listen to LBC all the time.
You called me my son. I'm not your son. I'm probably older than you are.
It's a term of endearment.
Well, endear this. Dear. Term of endearment. Ealing. Adam.
Yeah, hello.
Adam.
Yeah, hello.
Yes, Adam.
Yeah, I can hear you. Can I speak?
Yes, Adam. I can hear you too. That's like a coincidence.
Yeah. I just wanted to say good evening.
Good evening.
The fiasco about public England's data gathering measure just shows.
You mean the contract tasting? Is that what you're talking about?
No, contract like Boris was like molded up the other day. No, not that one.
Not that one.
They're counting anybody that's ever had COVID has died of COVID. And in March and in April, about a group of my friends, like six of us, said England's number was definitely exaggerated, and that was even before England or the UK took off as the highest numbers in Europe.
Yeah. So who said that our numbers were exaggerated?
It was all over the news today.
No, you said that a while ago.
Yeah, some of my friends and many people.
Okay, but what do they know?
What they know is there was incidents of many people that had their relatives died in care homes or in the community, and without even having a positive test of having died of COVID, their GP or their doctors or medical personnel died of COVID.
Right.
And there were instances of people going back to the medical professionals and saying, no.
Well, I'm highly suspicious of all of this. It sounds like revisionism on behalf of the government. They're trying to cover themselves and make their ineptitude seem less egregious by saying, all of these people have not died of COVID. They died of other unrelated things. Well, the numbers were damped down by not including people who died in care homes. So I rather suspect that the numbers, even though they're trying to make it appear as though they're better than they appear, I wouldn't be remotely surprised if they were actually worse.
It's not the government. It was Oxford statisticians or professors that pointed it out today. It was not the government at all. It was Oxford statisticians that saw that people that were tested positive of COVID in February, March, April, died in, let's say, 3 weeks ago in June, being counted as dead of COVID when they were.
Well, maybe they did. What did they die of?
Or maybe they didn't. But why would you say, but Scotland is not doing it that way. Wales is not doing it that way.
Well, every country on Earth is counting them slightly differently, which makes comparing and contrasting between countries difficult. But you know, some numbers are so huge that you have to think, well, there's something seriously amiss in this or that country, mentioning Belgium, no names.
Oh, shut up!
Belgium is a case in point. Belgium also exaggerated its numbers.
Yeah, so Belgium did, yeah.
Yeah, but once you had a cold or once you had a fever or any symptom at all, without having tested positively for COVID, they put them in the official...
Right, but to be fair, if you died of a cold while having COVID or while having recently had it, then it seems quite likely that you actually died of COVID, not a cold.
Yeah, I accept that. Of course, I accept that. But I'm seeing in the early days, in March or April, when some of my friends got together, there were people whose relatives have not even tested positive at all for COVID, where the medical professional just slapped COVID on the death certificate.
Well, why would they do that? If they haven't tested positive... Okay.
We had three people in London and one in Nottingham, and it was removed eventually because they protested. No, did you ever test my mom for COVID? They said no. They removed it and it was removed.
Four people?
That I know, yeah. That I knew within my circle of friends, six or seven of us that we knew. And it was largely, there was an article from a professor in Portsmouth around that time.
Right. Okay. So your position is that the government is not as cack-handed as most people.
I'm not saying that.
Believe.
England, UK has had one of the worst episodes, but it's not as dramatically bad.
Well, we don't know that. We don't know that. I mean, it's not an equation that only goes one way. I mean, it is entirely within the realms of possibility that the government is keeping the numbers artificially low. I mean, it might be actually worse than they are reporting. But keep your eyes peeled, Adam, and I want a full report on my desk first thing in the morning. Guildford, Abdul.
Hey.
Abdul.
How are you?
Good, thanks.
Do you have a sound bit clip for a devil's advocate?
No. What would that sound like?
I don't know. You're the expert on that.
I am an expert. I'm a world expert, yes.
Well, I just wanted to add my bit on, but then you've raised some other interesting points. But on coming, I just want to, you know, I don't have much of an opinion, but I just want to, for argument's sake, just to present the other side. Just wanted to see how that looks like. So what if people considered Dominic as the key essential worker for the government to, you know, help in bringing out the policies that the government needs,
etc.
So why don't I see anyone talking about the impact that would have been had he not travelled down, had he, you know, not been able to fulfil his duties the way he did, which we don't know of, just as for argument's sake. What if he would have been occupied with childcare and therefore we wouldn't have had a response like we did?
We would not have benefited from the excellence of his knowledge.
I mean, that's an opinion, right?
It is an opinion, yes, but that's based on the assertion that what we've had so far has been driven by excellence. Do you think our response to this virus has had the tinge of excellence about it?
But I feel it's easy to say now that we've got this data, right? And that JP Morgan study that you mentioned, they think that they know how this is going to pan out because they're saying it's not stopped the trajectory of the virus. So it seems like they know how it's going to end, which I don't think is something I can believe because no one really knows how this is going to end.
No,
right?
Well, so, I'm not talking about the future. I'm talking about up to this point. Do you think that this country has dealt with the virus in a way that is exemplary?
But I would... To do that, I'd have to compare other countries' responses.
Okay, well, we can do exactly that. We can talk about deaths per million. I mean, that's a pretty good indicator, isn't it? And we're doing spectacularly badly. In fact, it's embarrassing.
I would argue that that's because we're reporting it spectacularly. Not other countries. Or other countries are maybe not reporting it as well as we are.
right?
So that's the Donald Trump answer, I'm afraid, Abdul. If Donald Trump suggests that if you don't test, then you don't find any cases. Therefore, if you don't test, the virus does not exist.
So what I'm trying to say is the better indicator is the excess mortality. That's an indicator that would give you the exact number of people who have been impacted for any reason due to the coronavirus, right?
Well, no, if you go down that route, then you have to include all the excess deaths that will happen as a result of us being locked in, as a result of the economy crashing. The worst recession is predicted to be the worst recession in 300 years.
Predicted to be, that's all I'm trying to say. Predicted to be. In 2 months in to something, you can't really predict. I'm itching to go out now, right? I've got to celebrate Eid tomorrow, and I just can't sit. I don't want to sit at home, but I am. So now what I'm going to do is, when this is over, I'm going to do all of the things I've missed out on. So I guess there is this thing about people, right, that they adapt. Now we have adapted.
Well, now, what are all the things that you've missed out on? Name me three things.
I've missed out on traveling back home during this time, meeting my parents. I've missed out on having lunch gathering.
Restaurants, right?
Yeah, and then also for tomorrow, I won't be able to offer my obligatory prayers, and that is something that's very close to me. And I don't really agree with Donald Trump on everything, but on what he said about essential services for, all of the religious worship, places of worship, I do feel that's something that is true. It's close to my heart, and therefore I'm missing out on that as well.
Okay. Now, you can't pray without going to an established house of prayer? I mean, it hardly seems essential, does it? I mean, you can pray anywhere, can't you?
It is true, though, yeah. But in my faith,
you don't have to have a public show of piety, do you?
Nope, that's not what it is about. It's about the sanctity of the mosque. That's all it's about. Right. It's not about me not being
okay,
able
to... Okay, all right, I'm walking up the wrong road. I don't want to get into an argument about religion with you, but thanks for that, Abdul. Let's have Portsmouth. Ali.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
I think this coronavirus, somebody, somehow, somewhere, they created to target the older people to die. The reason why I say that, why is always targeting older people? Because they cannot breathe. They should have tell us 6 months before to say, oh, we've created this virus to kill older people. Then we could be like a shielded somewhere, somehow. But no, any other country in the world, they advise us like that. And I'm worried about myself and about all the older generation.
Yeah, well, if it's any help, I'm worried about you too, but that doesn't have anything to do with you catching the virus. What are you talking about?
This virus is not just a virus, it's somebody created.
To kill older people?
Yes, that's because they're human.
Why would they do that?
Because the human population is getting bigger.
Yeah.
And this planet cannot handle that many people.
Right.
And somehow they have to kill more people. I respect the younger generation, but that's what they do. They want to kill more people for the new generation.
Okay, I'll probably regret asking this, but who do you think is responsible?
Could be anyone. I'm not going to target one country. Could be anyone. Could be that... They had a meeting in France about the CO2 emission. Could be that. I don't know.
Well, it's probably the French, you think?
No, and it's not French. That happened in France, and the whole United Nations had a meeting in there.
Yeah.
Could be anyone. So
right.
I don't know, because they're hiding everything from us, from you, from me, from everyone, from our population. So they should have told us, we created that virus. If you're older than that age, we will kill you, basically.
Right. Yeah, they should have warned us. Yeah, you're quite right. I mean, if somebody is going to go to the trouble of creating a virus, is going to kill millions of old people, they should have just, sent out a memo, an email, perhaps.
Give us some sort of advance.
Yeah.
So their time's over, we will kill you in that time.
Right.
I had the coronavirus myself in 18th of December last year. I had it. Because I work in London every day.
Mm-hmm.
I had it. But I'm not that old to die.
I survived.
Right.
But they should have told us.
Yeah, I know. They should have posted around.
I think that would be...
Yeah, just pop the letter in the post.
Yeah, it's like a face mask. In the past 6-7 months, in all the world, they encourage people to wear face masks. Today or yesterday, they're telling us in the UK you have to wear face mask in the public transport. You knew that in the first place. Why didn't you tell us?
Well, I'm with you there, but only on that particular point. Everything else you've said doesn't seem to make any sense to me at all, but as long as it does to you, I guess that's the most important
part. It may not make a sense now,
yeah.
But you may realize
I'll come to realize that you were right. I very much doubt that.
But I don't know. That's my opinion, my friend.
Well, yeah, I know it's your opinion, but...
But it doesn't mean to say it's right. In the first place?
Yeah. Well, I'm with you on that. Yes, that seems to make perfect sense. I said it all along. Even if it doesn't help very much, even if it helps just a bit, then every little counts.
Exactly. But now they tell us you can make it your own at home.
Right.
Otherwise, we wouldn't have 40,000 people die in this country, and mainly the older people.
Yeah.
That's not fair. They pay taxes. They fought in the Second World War.
Not quite.
They fought for this country.
Yeah, probably not. There's old and there's old. I don't think there's many people who fought in the Second World War kicking around.
Even five, unless it isn't that 40,000 people, even five, that would make a huge difference for this country.
Yeah, I do agree with you on that point. If the person or persons unknown could just have been polite enough to pop a warning in the post, perhaps, that their intention was to kill a lot of old people, then it would have been polite.
Yeah, Boris Johnson, he sent a letter, a 50 million letter to every household. They could have sent a letter 3 months in advance.
Yeah, just to...
The virus coming by.
Yeah, exactly. A heads up that the plan is to kill a lot of old people. I mean, that would have just been considerate.
Be polite!
Thanks a lot, mate. Let's have a call in Bromley. Hello, Michael.
You alright, Nick? You alright, mate?
Yes, good, thanks.
Good, good. Well, I'm going to tell you something, Nick, yeah, and I want you to tell me if I'm a bad guy or not for saying it, yeah? A couple of days ago, I was in Sainsbury's, Nick, minding my own business, and some lady come up to me, and she said that I'm putting her health at risk because I'm not wearing a mask. But what I did, Nick, is I pointed to her basket, and I said that she's putting her own health at risk more than me. Now, her basket, Nick, was full of a load of junk food. Pepsi, ice cream, chocolate, and a load of processed food as well. Now, am I a bad guy for saying that, Nick? Because she wasn't really too happy with it.
Yeah. You sound like a troll. Are you trolling me?
I'm asking you an honest question.
Right.
Because you're an honest guy. You tell me if I'm a bad guy or not for saying it.
Right. Well, there's your answer. You're a troll. Stop trolling people. Back under your bridge, troll. Why weren't you wearing a mask?
Oh, this...
Because you can't be bothered.
Really it's
my right. I can do what I want. Yeah, one of those people.
Well, another safety worker wasn't wearing a mask as well.
That did strike me as being a bit bizarre. Because I went into a few shops and the customers were wearing masks, right enough, but the people behind the counter, the people working on the shop floor, weren't.
No.
Is that?
So why did she say that to them? But she said it to me though.
Yeah.
But I'm being honest with her. I'm saying, look. You're putting your own health at risk more than me. Look at, I didn't say it, but I pointed at a basket. So I'm being honest, Nick.
Well, now, wait a minute, back up. I thought you did say it. You told me just now you did say it.
Yeah, I said it to her.
Yeah.
I said she's putting her own health at risk more than me, not wearing a mask. And I pointed to her basket. It's full of a load of junk food.
Junk food, yeah.
Pepsi, ice cream, chocolate.
I wish you'd stop saying. I wish you'd stop saying Pepsi. Pepsi is a fine product, and I'll hear nothing said against it.
And other products.
Yes.
But you reckon I'm a bad guy?
Because
I see you two cut them off friends. They say, "No, mate, you're being honest."
Right, because they're your friends.
No.
People choose their friends because they think alike.
My friends do say not, but I don't like this new mask Nazi.
Nobody does.
sort of thing we've got to conform to. So if you don't wear a mask, oh, you're a bad guy, you're a devil, you are.
There's but all again, sorts of rules and regulations that make society rub along just fine.
And
don't punch strangers in the face is one of them. Do you chafe at that regulation? Don't nick other people's stuff. That's another regulation. Don't park in a place that somebody else was going towards. Don't nip in there just at the last moment and claim that it's yours. You know, be polite.
Yeah, but I'm sure not wearing a mask exactly isn't going to cause troubles, really, is it? The virus has come here and all these rules that are coming here, you listed them out earlier, Nick. Come on, mate. Honestly, they're a joke. It is. I don't even know what the rules are. No,
okay, well, but you know the rule about the masks, though.
Yeah, but it still was. It's a.
Because you don't want to.
No, yeah, but it's not going to basically.
You don't know that.
Is it?
You've got no idea what you're talking about. You don't wear a mask because you don't.
Matt Hancock does.
You don't want to.
They failed with Mark. They failed with the time.
All of that's completely irrelevant. It's totally irrelevant. The rule that you know is that you wear a mask in a shop. That is, that's about the only clear rule that we've got right now. Everybody knows that that's the rule. but you don't want to because you don't want to.
Nick, if there was a vaccination come out next week, would you get it or not?
Of
even
course.
Like the 12th.
Yes.
But what? Even though it could give you long-term health effects, we don't know the... I mean, they failed on PPE, they failed on a lockdown, they failed on everything else. What gives us guarantee they're not going to fail on a vaccination, Nick?
Well, it wouldn't be the government making the vaccination, so that would be one positive step.
The other companies done PPE, didn't they, and all that. They failed as well.
No, they didn't fail. We failed in acquiring the PPE.
I would have no trust in it. I'd wait 10 years to see the long-term effect, Nick.
Yeah, but in the meantime, you might die.
Well, I'm only 34. I've got the antibodies. So I'm sure I'll be okay.
How do you know you got the antibodies?
Because I took the test. I did. All of my family got it. We did. And we had it other than we got it before it actually got public. Maybe in January.
But what makes you trust the test? Because you don't trust anything else.
Well, touché, Nick. Touché.
Yeah, because it gave you the excuse to go out and do what you want. Yeah, it gave you the result that you were after. Anything that doesn't give you the result that you were after or impedes your immediate pleasure is fake news. Yeah, I get it. All right, thanks a lot, Michael. Thanks for your cooperation. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
Whizbeach, hello, Oliver.
How you doing?
Good, thanks.
Hey, how you doing? Is it Nick or Nicholas?
It's Nick.
Oh, Nick. How you doing, Nick? Nick, I just wanted to ask you a question, on the pubs basically of the UK. Why are people have to wear masks in supermarkets and not in pubs? It's a very simple question, but I don't think it's been asked.
Because you can't drain beer through a mask.
Yeah. So why are they allowed to open then?
Well, because if they don't, they'll never reopen.
Oh, give me a logical answer.
Money.
What?
Honey.
Yeah, money. Yeah.
That's it.
Well, what's that got to do with health, though? Would you rather people die or would you rather people be alive?
Well, it depends on which people we're talking about.
Well, we're talking about just generally everyone. Telling people to wear masks in supermarkets and you know, various other places?
Right, for obvious reasons.
For obvious reasons. So why do you think the pandemic's going to come back? It's because we're allowing people to walk into pubs.
Yes.
Yeah, so where's the logic in that? Can you explain that to me? Well, no, it's
yeah,
not a
well,
question
if,
for you.
If you just stop speaking for a second, I will explain it to you. Because people die not necessarily just because of the COVID virus. Death is not only associated with people who have the virus.
No,
death...
you're missing the point, though, Nick.
No, you're missing the point.
Please go back to the question. Why are you allowing people...
I'm answering the question. If you just stop speaking for a second and listen to me.
I will, then. Go on, then. Carry on.
Death... Hello? Death is not a recent invention. Death happens all the time for many different reasons, amongst which poverty ranks way up there, and poverty will be all about if the economy doesn't get going again.
Well, just because of pubs being closed?
No, not just pubs. Everything.
If, so why isn't
if you object to pubs being closed, then you should being open rather, then you should also object to restaurants being open and theatres certainly and cinemas and all the rest of it.
Why are you allowed to wear why aren't you allowed to? Why are you meant to wear masks in
a supermarket?
Supermarkets and
but not in a pub. Because you can't strain beer through a mask, you idiot.
Yeah, well, obviously, but that still doesn't answer my question,
does
it?
It does!
It doesn't answer the question. Where's the logic?
The logic is that if we don't get the economy of this country moving,
we're all going to die. The pubs are solely our economy in the UK, then, are they?
No. God, you are not listening to a single thing I'm saying, are you?
You think pubs take more money than supermarkets?
Of course not. People have to eat. They have to go to the supermarket. They do not have to go to the pub. They don't have to go to the restaurant or the cinema or the theatre or to shops. But if they don't, we don't have an economy anymore, which will cause more deaths than the virus.
I'm not saying that, though. I'm saying, why are people allowed to go to supermarkets and they have to wear a mask, but pubs are... okay to just do what you want in there, you know, just spread it around like you can.
Do you have waxy build-up? I think you need to go to your GP and get your ears syringed. You keep asking me the same question, I keep giving you the same correct answer, but you're not hearing it. Principally, I suspect, because you're not interested in hearing it, you just are interested more in hearing the sound of your own voice. As though you think you have discovered some truth that is unavailable to the rest of humankind. That you maybe read it on the internet, I bet.
What do I know about it? All I know is what's on the internet.
Either way, you are an extremely annoying person and you have delighted us enough. Carl in Greenwich. Carl.
Hi, Nick. How are you?
Good, thanks.
Thanks for taking my call. Yeah, it was about Dominic Cummings. Now, I don't understand why people are gunning for him. They want him out. I mean, if you or me break the law, i.e. we break the lockdown conditions, we would get fined, won't we?
Perhaps, if we get caught.
If we get caught, and obviously if you get proved that you have broken the law, and they say, okay, you have to pay £1,000 fine. And you know, same applies to Neil Ferguson, the scientist. And these are key people that we need at this moment. So, I mean, personally, I think they should just get fined and move on.
Yes, except for the part that it's not the supposed crime now. It's the attempt to cover up the crime that's the story now.
Okay, but... they still haven't proved it. I mean, okay, you know, you got all this. The news is saying, yeah, he has done it, but he's denying it. He says he's, you know, followed the rule as he's supposed to, and you know, so you know, he's not guilty until proven guilty, isn't he?
Well, so, yes, you know, at what point do you accept the evidence? I mean, somebody, two different people saw him. You've got multiple witnesses, you've got a police report. How much evidence do you need?
Well, I mean, if it's proven that he's definitely guilty, the point I'm making is that, okay, you say he's guilty, okay, he's guilty, right? And you say he's got the witnesses and the police and ABC.
Yeah, I'm not saying he's guilty. I'm suggesting that the evidence that's been laid before us suggests that is the case. The evidence to the contrary is them saying, oh no, it isn't. That's it.
Yeah, so that's what I mean. So far as they're concerned, they haven't broken the law. But far as the news and the paparazzi is concerned, he has broken the rules and the police. So therefore, until he's proven that he's guilty, you know, he shouldn't go. But you know, rather than say, you know, I mean, he is a key, as you correctly said earlier on, you know, he
runs the government behind,
Yes, well, okay, so we must pause and think about that for a second. If that is the case, if he is the giant brain behind the government's actions on this issue, has he done a good job? Has this country performed well in tackling this virus? And all of the evidence suggests that we have done very badly. So this might be a golden opportunity to get rid of somebody who's actually not very good.
Well, I mean, you may be right. But on the other hand, I mean, it's a new thing for us, for everyone around the world. You have to tackle it the best way possible.
Well, yes. And some countries have done significantly better than us. In fact, almost all countries have done better than us. Well, there's only three, maybe four countries that have done worse than us so far.
Sure. I mean, there's obviously things that needs to be addressed as well, these issues, as you say, the PPE and so on and so forth. But going back to, if you want to get rid of him and you want to use this as a reason to get rid of him, so be it.
Well, you could say that, but that's not really what's happening here. You could say that it's shown that he actually might not be as bright as people are insisting.
Making it out to be, yeah. But, I mean, do we have a choice? The point is that we're in a situation, in a very bad place, as you know.
Yes, and we want only the best people to be leading us. Do any of his actions thus far lead you to believe that he is the best person for the job?
I can't answer that because, I mean, I'm not there, so I can't really say.
Well, from what you know. Hasn't gone well so far. All right, I got it out of you in the end. Thanks a lot, Carl. Marylebone, Adnan.
Hey, Nick.
Adnan.
Hi. Firstly, I just wanted to say thank you for being one of the few journalists who actually speak sense.
I'm not a journalist, but thanks.
Broadcaster.
Yeah, all right. More or less.
More or less.
I'm a talk show host, but I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Yeah.
You're welcome. I wanted to make a few points. I think the first point was I totally agree with you that history will show that we completely overreacted to this virus, or
yes,
at least our actions were disproportionate
mm-hmm.
to what happened.
Yeah.
But I think, unfortunately, that may not happen because I think the government will continuously censor sensible comments. I mean, you see a change in how people can, what they can post, what they can say, and what they can't.
Really?
So,
where? What do you mean?
Well, I mean, for example, the 5G thing that went on a month ago is stupid. It's ridiculous. We all know that. But it was censored.
How do you mean? What was censored about it?
Well, I think there were posts that were taken down from social media that were basically putting forward theories about how 5G causes the virus.
Right.
And I think Twitter and Facebook and these sort of places all took them down, and the government was censoring certain broadcasters, journalists, whatever.
Were they?
Yes. Yeah, you've got to look it up.
Well, I will not look it up.
I know, you won't look it up. It's crazy. But I wanted to say, the main point was, I think this whole lockdown is completely nonsense as well. I think in terms of coming out of this lockdown, either you have a lockdown or you don't.
Yeah.
Where we are now is, we'll think about it on the 4th of July and we'll start easing restrictions. There's absolutely no difference between now and the 4th of July.
No.
There's no cure.
None that I can see. No.
No. So in a way, I think the government and people that have followed their advice are so invested in this coronavirus and the fact that they're so scared that this would kill them and this is a silent killer, et cetera, et cetera, that they're buying into this, and the statistics are completely the opposite. You've got less than 1% chance of dying of this. This R number they keep throwing out is only based on what information you put into that R number.
Yeah, of course.
That information is based on how many people you test.
Yeah, exactly.
You have rapid testing.
Yes.
So, I think you're absolutely spot on, and it's really refreshing to hear this because everywhere else, every other broadcaster, journalist, it's all doom and gloom. I think the government have got this completely wrong.
Westminster. Hello, Ken.
Good evening, Mr. Bishop.
Hello,
thank
Ken.
You for taking my call.
Thank you for good making your evening. Call.
Yeah.
Welcome along to the show. Ken, can I ask you a question? Have you accepted?
Go ahead.
Have you accepted Jesus into your life?
Oh, I did 40 years ago. Only 40 years ago.
What happened before 40 years ago?
I was living
you were
in
a
sin
sinner,
the same as you.
A sinner 40 years ago. Have you confessed your sins?
I was on the highway.
A highway to hell, like
AC/DC.
Rock and roll!
You are on the highway to hell, my friend.
I know, we're holding hands.
Listen to this, please. Listen to this, Nick. We are possibly headed into the greatest depression in world history.
Yeah, when I saw your call was the next one up, I did enter the greatest depression in world history. That is a fact. Thanks, Ken. It's been delightful having a chat. Let's have Edinburgh. Eric.
Hi, Mick. All right.
Yeah, good, thanks.
I'm going to have to disagree with you. On hydroxychloroquine, it is an effective drug. In India, they've used it with their healthcare workers and not one person has died.
In India?
Yes. And also, Dr. Zelenko in New York has used it with no hospitalizations.
Yeah. Other studies have suggested over and over again that it causes the complication of death.
Well, it's been used for 60 years. So
yes, but not in this context.
Well, yes, but you've got to use it at the early stage of the virus, not the late stage.
Right, so everybody should go onto a malaria pill that could cause you to stop breathing and be buried underground, just in case Donald Trump's right.
No, not Donald Trump. Scientists across the world. 68,000 people have used it for arthritis, and only 4 people have become infected for 68,000.
Have become infected with what?
COVID.
Study after study after study shows that if you try to treat this disease with that medicine, you are at a greater risk of dying than if you don't.
No, that's not true. That's what you choose to believe.
It's not what I choose to believe. It's what scientific data tells you.
Well,
it's not an either-or. We're not... Okay, there's absolutely no point in having this conversation, Eric, and I just don't have the strength there anymore. I would tell you to look it up on the internet, but you're looking in all of the wrong places. So don't. Turn the internet off. Log out and walk away from the screen. Here's Tackleston, wherever that is. Alan.
Yeah, well, it's about 12 miles south of Norwich.
Is it?
Yeah.
Well, it sounds like a delight. Flat round there, I bet.
Yeah, it's lovely, actually.
Yeah.
Lovely.
Are we on speakerphone?
I am sorry.
Oh, my God.
How's that?
There you are.
Yeah, sorry, I apologise. I should have known better. what occurred to me recently is, you know that expression, history repeating itself?
No.
Well.
Yes.
You do.
Yeah, I do, yeah.
You do. Right, okay. The Salem witch hunts?
Yeah.
Remember them?
No, I was, it had nothing to do with me, Governor.
No, me neither.
It was like that when I got there.
And... my great-great-grandfather was Jack the Ripper's, but
yeah, no doubt.
My fault, you know, so don't blame me.
I am blaming you.
Okay. Anyway, the point I was trying to make is that you got these teenage girls saying, she's a witch, and they go to court and they hang all these poor people. Hmm. And it got to the point where they was accusing the governor of that particular area, wife, of being a witch, and he went, hang on a minute, no, I'm not having this.
Yeah.
Put the brakes on it. And you draw a parallel with the corona, or insane virus as I call it, and that's what it needs. It needs someone to say, whoa, hang on a minute, this has gone too far. Do you know what I mean?
I think we've gone down this road, it's almost too late to do anything else, and but we're attempting to do that. We're attempting to open things up while the situation remains the same. The virus is still there. We ain't got no vaccine. We ain't got no treatment. And nothing's changed, apart from where, there's a lot of people who got ill, a lot of people who got dead. But other than that, the situation is similar to how it started. So,
and that is very, very sad. But when you have an outbreak of an epidemic, you don't isolate the fit people. Like the bubonic plague, for example, you actually isolated the people that were sick, not the healthy people. And that's where it's all gone bus-eyed.
I'll maintain my position. If we'd all done a Sweden plus masks, then the entire world would not be facing catastrophe as it is.
I totally agree with you. Absolutely. I'm not sure about the mask because the virus thing is capable of getting through a bit of cotton, you know.
Yes, that's right. But the thing with masks is that it doesn't protect you, it protects other people from you. So if everybody wears them, then, in certain circumstances, then even by protecting you a bit, that's better, surely.
Well, I think this is all a bit of PR, this mask stuff, because the government have done such a good job of scaring the heck out of people. The only way they can get them out and about again is say, well, wear masks, and that makes them feel better. But I mean, I've stopped going to the supermarket now. I do click and collect because you walk into the supermarket and everyone gives you evils, and I've got one of these plasterers dust mask things,
right?
Because there's no way I'm going to spend £10 on a bit of cloth. I thought, no, I'm going to opt out. So we do click and collect, and the guy comes out, and he said, he's a lovely guy, by the way, and he says, oh, it's murder in there, everyone's so tense, they're all edgy. And I think, well, this is because the government's created this fear factor. Do you know what I mean?
Well, it's very easy to instill fear in the population. It's much more difficult to say that the coast is clear, you'll come out now. Yeah.
No, exactly right. And this mask thing is part of that. And the next thing will be the magic pill, which will be a placebo, I expect, and everyone will take, and they'll all come out, oh, we're all fit again now, you know.
Well, now we're straying into conspiracy theory territory.
David Icke, no, I get you. I know that. I totally concur with that. But the point is, you draw the parallel with the witch hunts, and it fits like a glove. It really does.
Right, well, if you say so. I'm not entirely convinced about that whole witch hunt thing, but I think we're in agreement about much else.
Not literally.
I get it. I understand.
The fabric of it.
Yeah, no.
Mm-hmm. Fabric.
Right. Fabric, yeah. Okay.
Fabric.
I get it. Fabric. Lewisham. Hello, Jane.
Hi there.
Hello there.
Was you at the seaside?
Oh, my God, you're so loud. Can you back off the phone a couple of feet?
No. Was you at the seaside yesterday?
Was I? No, I was not.
The day before?
No. No, I haven't been to the seaside this year. Not since last summer was I at the seaside, beside the sea.
Oh, that's terrible.
What?
It was beautiful yesterday.
Yeah, I can imagine.
I remember it for always. Mm. It was such a special, special day.
Yes.
And all the people were so happy.
Weren't they? Just. Yes, up to their eyeballs with happiness they were.
That's the best medicine anyone could have, to go to the seaside. Mm. I thought you were, what was you doing then? Just moving around at home then?
Yes. Going to the seaside, I'm not really sure. But I mean, you certainly don't want to go in the sea because, there's things that are swimming in the sea that science hasn't even discovered yet. They have got no idea what's in the sea, but I have a fair, I personally have a fair idea, and it's not something you'd want to get on you, not even on the bottom of your shoe.
Oh, you just have to get tough, don't you?
No, I absolutely do not.
Mind you, I'm not a good swimmer, but, lots of people are, and they've thoroughly enjoyed themselves. And that's, but people are beginning to think now that we should never have had the lockdown in the beginning.
People, I've been saying this all along.
Oh, it's just turned out awful, hasn't it? Awful.
It's like, it sounds like you're describing the weather. Oh, it's turned out awful, hasn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, if the weather had been terrible, then we would not be out cramming parks and beaches and so on. We'd be gladly staying in, binge watching The Sopranos. But unfortunately, it seems to be turning into the best summer ever.
Yeah, make the most of it. You know, we need the vitamin D.
Yeah, we do. That's right. That's absolutely right. Yeah. I actually started taking multivitamins just specifically because of that. I thought I may lack vitamin D, so I'm going to squirt some up me. And so I take it. I'm taking a vitamin pill now that says, God, it's absolutely enormous. It's like a Domino's tile. You know, it's like a horse
pill. If you eat the right food,
yeah,
and you do go out in the sunshine.
Oh, well, go out in the sunshine part. I avoid the sunshine because of my bright whiteness. I am so white, I'm practically see-through. Sort of a dazz bluey white me.
So yeah, but if you went out in the sunshine, you wouldn't be.
I'd burst into flames if I went out in the sunshine. You're listening to what I'm telling you. I'm too white to go in the sun.
Well, sit under the shade. Or something.
Exactly, but that's not in the sun.
Under a parasol.
You don't get vitamin D through a parasol.
You do. You would.
No, so I'm getting it from eating a multivitamin pill, which I used to do for about 10 years when I was younger. And I stopped it one day, and absolutely nothing happened, other than my pee stopped being like a luminous green colour. That's the only thing that changed. Nothing else changed. The money that I spent on multivitamins, what a waste. And I've started again because, you know, why not?
Uh-huh, yeah. So that's it. So we've decided the lockdown is just absolutely awful for everyone. Certain people that are going to get are liable to get the COVID-19, and then they didn't look after them. They've just done the whole thing wrong. The people that they should have looked after, they didn't. And then they locked up all the rest of us, all the healthy people.
Yeah.
And
they allowed 20 million people to pour in from every virus hotspot on Earth with no checks to mingle among us.
It's just, but do you think now that the only way forward is, you know, for most people, it is very mild. You know, you might get a cough, you might get sneezing, like a cold or mild flu for most people. So the way forward is for everyone to get it and get over it and build up an immunity to it.
Yeah, unfortunately, if we'd started out like that and used our common sense, of which there seems to be a certain lacking, but if we'd done a Sweden... Absolutely in us, in everybody. It's a part of the human condition. But if we'd done a Sweden, then we would not be in the mess that we're in at the moment. That seems to be obvious to me. I mean, there would still have been a lot of deaths, but deaths is not a new phenomenon. People die all the time.
You could have looked after the people that needed looking after extra.
Yes.
You'd just be looking after them, wouldn't you?
Yes.
Not the rest.
Not everybody.
Need looking after.
Yes. I'll say it again. I think that historians will look back at this being the biggest overreaction to anything in history. See, this is what we're setting ourselves up for. This virus, as you are describing, is not very...
not very bad for most people.
Exactly, it's not very
bad. And most people won't even know they've got it.
If it had been like...
You know, they just sneeze a couple of times, yeah, and hay fever would be worse.
If we'd had a virus like SARS or MERS, which was taking about 30% of the people that got it, it had a kill rate of about 30%. If this thing that we've got now was like that, then yes, of course, everybody gets locked up. But it isn't. It's
you never lock everybody up anyway.
Huh?
You know, you shouldn't lock anybody up anyway.
Well, it depends.
But once we've sorted this, which I think everybody get it and get over it.
Right.
And then we do have to, so this globe is in the people. It's in a real mess, isn't it? with the people that are running it, and we've got to rethink. And,
yeah, we've got to stage an intervention. Yeah,
and get it sorted properly.
Right. Well, leave it with me. Let's have a call in Brisbane. Hello, Josh.
How are you?
Good, thanks.
Hey, thanks for taking my call, Nick.
Thanks for making your call.
Thank you. So,
no, thank you.
Thank you.
Yes. Go ahead.
The United Kingdom has one of the highest death rates of any country in the world.
In the world.
The United Kingdom does, yes.
I know it does. In the world, yeah.
Right after Belgium.
We're doing very, very badly.
And I think there's a reason for that.
Go on.
I'm very much about believer in the Lord, a God is in charge of everything.
Uh-oh.
So.
Uh-oh.
I know.
Well, then, this. He, she, or it is responsible for the virus.
Well, you know, he's the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. So when the end comes, you know, he's in charge. And I think most people know that.
Right. You know, so is that a yes? He, she, or it is responsible for the virus?
I would agree with that, yeah. Right. I mean, he's allowing it to manifest for the harvesting, yeah.
For the harvesting? What does that mean?
The harvest, yeah.
What does that
mean?
Well,
I'm going to get into this in a second, but I'd like to just take
a moment. You may not have a second. there is that.
Please don't. I mean, come on. I call in here.
Yeah, just because you called doesn't mean to say you can take over the show.
I'm not wanting to take over your show, but I do want to share some wisdom if I think I've
okay. Well, why don't you put it on a postcard and stick it up the post? Because I really don't want a lesson about your religiosity. Thanks, but no thanks. Oh my God, it can't be true. Again, Stockton-on-Tees. Hello, Brian.
Yeah, good evening, Nick.
Brian.
Good to talk to you. Come on, summer's here and the time is right for dancing in the street.
Yeah.
It's got to happen, hasn't it?
Are you dancing?
It's got to happen.
Are you dancing?
Yeah. I'm dancing because you've got the ground.
No. Back up. Are you dancing?
If you want me to.
No. Don't you know it? Are you dancing?
If you're asking.
Close.
Got it?
Are you dancing?
I thought it was if you're asking or something, wasn't it?
No. How can people not know this? Particularly you, okay, of your advanced years, if you don't mind me saying so, and where you come from. Are you dancing?
If you're asking, I don't know.
So close, yet so far. Oh, well, you fail this test.
Yeah, what is it then, Owen?
Well, you look it up later. I'm giving you homework.
Right.
Anyway.
I agree with on this.
What?
Overhyped. It's all been overhyped. Yeah, I do agree with on this for one of the first times I have.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, I must. If you're agreeing with me now, then I'd like to revisit my original
opinion.
I've got
a disagreement with you just now, like. I've got another disagreement with you after this, like.
Oh, okay.
On
course.
This. From this,
yes.
I mean, from the very start, that so-called expert, Neil Ferguson, he's never been right on anything, Nick. He's not in the wrong field. He's 10 fields away. He's been that wrong.
Well, right? I don't know. He can't have been wrong about everything his entire life. Not to have got the position. To his exalted position.
Right, right. He come out and he said there'll be 500,000 deaths.
Yeah.
Now, come on. If we'd all put each of us tongues down each other's necks, we wouldn't have 500,000. You know, he's always wrong. You know.
Well, there could have been. You don't know. We don't know. It's absolutely true. There could have been.
At the moment, he hasn't been 500,000 in the world.
Well,
he's always wrong.
I'm not sure that's right, actually. Has there not been 500,000 in the world? That's correct. Anyway.
200,000 last time I looked.
Right.
The other day. Right, so as soon as he said that, I mean, this bloke just wants to be on the news all the time, this Ferguson.
Right,
he comes out with things all the time.
I very much doubt that's true.
Well, it is true. You have only been watching about him, like. I mean, he's even come out afterwards and said, should we have went into lockdown? He keeps switching, so he'll be right, you know.
Yeah, well,
you can't keep up the news.
Yeah, I don't think we should have done. I think we should have done Sweden.
Yes, but what could the Conservative government do once he blurted that out?
They could ignore him like they ignore whatever scientists they choose to ignore.
But you said he could have been right. You actually said that then.
Well, yeah, he could have been.
If he was anywhere near right, there would have been shout. It could have destroyed the concept of government, couldn't it? There could have been said, the whole country could have said, you got warned, look what's happened. So there was 100,000 to 200,000 deaths now.
Yeah.
They'd be screaming for another government, wouldn't you?
Well, we wouldn't get one. that's the nature of our screwed up system, is you get what you're given, pretty much. Most people get what they're given. They don't get what they vote for, they get what they're given. And they have to stick it for 5 years.
But the thing is, it's continued, all this need and all the lot. The thing is now, people are going to, it's summer, they're going to go out.
Yeah.
And we've just got to take from where it is now and get on with life. The ones, I mean, there's seen 500,000 on the beach at Brighton. Yes, but don't forget, there's probably 60-odd million still being careful. But, you know, but nobody talks about that, you know.
Well, it's not news. nobody talks about it.
But that's true though, Nick, isn't it? The 60-odd million, being careful still, because you got maybe it's a couple of million, you know, it's all big news. But come on, most of the country are still, even though they want to go out, they're going to be careful going out.
Yeah, not maybe. A little bit careful. I think we're being less and less careful as every day passes by, because I think that in people's minds, and this is understandable, I suppose, we're presented with a threat that we can't see, touch, feel, or smell. And so we're just on trust, being accepting that there is a threat, and we have to do the following in order to prevent ourselves from getting it. But the longer the longer it goes that you don't get it, the less likely it appears to you that you are going to get it. But that is not necessarily true.
But why I'm agreeing with you, Nick, is we don't want to talk about deaths, but there's been 3 children under 5 died, up to about 25 or 30 year old. I think it's about 400-odd people have died. It's been mainly older people.
Right.
Or people who had underlying conditions.
Yes.
Now that just doesn't happen with this coronavirus. It happens with the flu and all other things.
Well, most deaths occur when people are reaching what is normally thought of as the end of their experience.
It's the travelator
of life.
Yeah, it's an awful thing to say, Nick, but it's finished them off, hasn't it, in other cases? It finishes people off this.
Yeah.
In a lot of cases, you know. But it's learned also in this country, look, too many have got diabetes, too many are overweight.
Yeah.
I mean, even nurses, when you go in the hospital, a lot of the nurses, actual nurses, are overweight.
Well, we are, I think, the third fattest country in the world, aren't we?
Yeah, you know. And that's a problem. We have more deaths because of that as well, aren't we? But anyway, we are where we are. We've got to get on with it. And get back as normal as soon as possible, being as careful as you can. My disagreement with you, Nick, is every time you mention Boris Johnson, you link him with Trump.
Yes.
It's all that. You know, this is just old Marxist lefty stuff that we're peddling out all the time, you know. We're not going to fall for it, Nick. You keep doing it.
Joking? They're the same person.
The only people who are agreeing with you is the ones who are Marxist leftists.
Right.
You're not going to win anybody else over.
Marxist leftists. You don't see any correlation between Donald Trump and his mini-me. He actually called him his mini-me. He said mini-Trump. That's what he said.
No.
He did. Donald Trump called Boris Johnson mini-Trump. That's what he called him.
Look, I'm going to come out. Is he anything like Trump, really?
He's completely like Donald. First of all, people voted for him because he was that funny bloke off the telly and he didn't like foreigners.
Right.
That's what. Right. So they're twinned at the hip with those two characteristics.
Would you have wanted Jeremy Corbyn to have been Prime Minister? Come on.
He couldn't possibly have fared worse with the virus than Boris Johnson has.
Yeah, they have been poor with the virus, but the medical as well. I mean, you went on about masks, didn't you? There's a top medical one who said, it doesn't matter if you wear a mask. So they were to blame as well on that. They've mucked it up together, haven't they?
The medical, when they keep saying we're just following the science, what they mean is they're following the science that they want to follow.
But I've heard you say tonight, you said, we wouldn't have had to go into lockdown if we'd have wore masks. The reason we never went wore masks was
we didn't have any. Because we did not have any. It's true. It's absolutely true. The reason that they kept saying don't wear masks is because there weren't any.
Nick, just a covering, not even a proper mask. You could have had a covering, you could have had a bandana, you could have had a...
Well, I'm sure that didn't even occur to... I'm sure it didn't even occur to them.
You know, you could have homemade one. But they made it clear, didn't they? That's why we're not wearing them now.
They made it clear that they did not want us to wear a mask because the medical profession didn't have enough masks, so they didn't want us to take their stock. That's the reason why they said don't wear a mask, is because there weren't any.
But I don't agree with Nicola Sturgeon at all, really. Nicola Sturgeon come out and she said, just put a covering on. It's better than nothing.
Yeah, just put a bag on your head.
Yeah, you know, covering it, and it stops the spray and what have you. You know, but...
That seems logical to me.
But you've got to finally, I've been listening to you for, 3 years, 4 years.
Yeah.
And I've never heard you say one good word about Boris Johnson.
Hmm. Well, what does that tell you?
It just tells you have a complete bias again. You know.
Yeah, I'd say that's about right, yeah. I have a complete bias against people who are not acting in my interests.
And you're not getting any more people against Johnson with this crap about
I don't have to make him more unpopular. He's doing a tremendous job of doing that himself.
It's been happening by the left for years and years, trying to do this, and it doesn't wash. It only washes with the ones who are actually converted left.
Well, I think there are more and more converts every passing day.
Going to get some new material on this.
Yeah,
you know,
okay, sure.
From another angle.
All right, leave it with me. There's another one giving me homework. Thanks a lot, Brian.